All right, we're back at the Kennedy Space Center, live coverage of the launch of the Discovery 7. Walter Cronkite here, Gunter Wendt here. Illustrious bookends for me. Gentlemen, good to see you both. And right before we had that break...
It's the book that counts.
That's right. Right before we had that break, Gunter brought his photo book. And let's take a look at this seat. Tell me about the seat that John Glenn and the other Mercury astronauts use.
All you need is electrodes to use that okay. Sing Sing.
Yeah. Right. No, actually, what we did, or what McDonald did at that time, they invited all the astronauts to go ahead, go to the plant. Then they had them lean over and make a plaster cast of their back in the flight configuration. And then they made fiberglass seats that were actually molded to their body in a way. So each astronaut had their own seat. By the way, we also made a couch for Ham and Enos because they were first, and we had to make sure that we could do that. So these are the couches that were labeled, and if we ever changed from one crew to another, we had to change the couches.
Well, but now this was, who was going, for example, on the first mission? Alan Shepard.
Alan Shepard,
this
right.
was a state secret at that point,
it
right?
It was.
And so what they did was they took great pains to make sure that no one knew which seat had been installed in that capsule, right?
That's correct. What we did is in order to, we were still worried that the Russians might get us because we were in a race with them. So we wanted to make sure that they didn't know which astronaut was going first, so in case they wanted to do something to him. So what we did when we installed the couches, Bob Graham, which was the capsule manager at that time, and myself, we took all the name tags and all the identification tags off these capsule pieces before we handed them to the technicians to install. So nobody really knew until very shortly before launch, I mean, I think a day before launch, which astronaut was going to be the first one. Because in the early Mercury days, we were worried that some of these trawlers that you could see offshore, the Russian fishing boats, so to speak, with radar domes, would send us a destruct signal and blow us up. Because, you know, you didn't trust anybody at this time, so we were very, very careful to make sure that we didn't give them an opening.
Walter Wendt, do you remember knowing when, or remember the time frame when you understood it was going to be Alan Shepard on that first flight? Was it pretty much right up to launch day, or was there some period of time beforehand?
I don't remember specifically, tell you the truth, Miles, when we learned that it was Alan. It seems to me it was fairly late on, but yeah. I can't recall.
And we used to rotate. Remember, Gordo did once that pull, I don't want to go, and then Scott came in and Glenn was the backup. So you really didn't know which one was the real one. Will the real one stand up?
There was a three-part selection. Glenn and Alan and who was the third?
I think Cooper was the other one. They were the three top guys. And
there's actually a picture in Time in Life magazine of the three out of whom one would be going. I think they got it down to that.
It was very, very competitive. I mean, you need to understand, everybody was fighting for a seat in the spacecraft. Yeah. And I think that went on all through the program. You had to fight to get a seat. There were always more people or more astronauts than there were seats.
Yeah.
So it was a constant fight, do better than the other guy.
That was a tough job running that astronaut office down in Houston, having to make the ultimate decision and announcing it to the men who were your colleagues, your friends, you've been through training with. You suddenly had to say, you're not going, you
are. I think Deke Slayton had a great hand in that, and somebody ever said, you know, if you get on the bad side of Deke, don't ever expect to fly.
Yeah.
Deke Slayton, of course, one of the original Mercury 7, who did not fly until Apollo Soyuz, who was very instrumental in the selection process all along, and universally respected by the astronauts, was he not?
He was very much respected by him. Yeah. But it was a tough thing. The competition was very, very great, and I think it even is today. You have to excel in whatever you are assigned to do, be a payload specialist or be this, and you have to fight for your seat, because look, you know, today we got, 180 astronauts.
The one thing you have to remember is that these men were all military pilots, and they had learned something of military discipline, chain of command. They understood the necessity of somebody making decisions and enforcing them. And while they all fought for a seat, there weren't many complaints except privately that they didn't make it. They didn't complain to the boss himself, I don't think, very much.
Right, it was very interesting, I mean, the competitiveness. No. And like you say, you compare things today and they were then, I remember one time, a famous restaurant here, Ramon's, we were testing late in the evening, and the guys wanted to go home, and I asked them, would you be happy with ham and cheese sandwiches? And they said, yes. So I ordered 100 sandwiches and then 2 ounces of coffee to pick up at the South Gate to bring in. At that time, I could sign a slip, you know, McDonald's had a, I had enough petty cash to go around. Now today you couldn't do that anymore. They wouldn't even let them in the gate. But they were what they called the old times, yeah. But we enjoyed it. Now, I just had a thought today, Walter. They're saying, okay, what's the young people? You know, I like to work with young people. What's in it for us? And I always like to compare two things. I said, you need to understand, if you look back in the past, and you can't live in the past, we, our generation, we developed a Model T Ford. I said, why don't you guys go ahead and develop a Corvette? Yeah. And that would be, besides that, if you look for security, look at this way, be an astronaut and you got a 40-year job. Look at John.
All right, we need to take a break. The Corvette is fueled and ready. The occupants are getting inside as we speak. Steve Lindsay on the right-hand seat there. We're going to take a brief break. We promise we will give you the entry into the Space Shuttle Discovery of John Glenn when we return. Stay with CNN.
Nobody loves cars more than I do. Each one is a work of art. So when the maker of all these chose a new antifreeze, it got my attention.
General Motors now uses the DexCool technology of Havoline Extended Life Antifreeze in virtually all its new vehicles. The same patented formula you can use in your car for 5 years or 150,000 miles. So do what GM did. Switch to Havoline.
I use it in my car. I only wish this were it.
Introducing the new Nicotrol inhaler. Now available by prescription. Ask your doctor if it's right for you. For more information, visit our website or call 1-800-INHALER.
When arthritis pain hurts, you want relief fast. But pills can have side effects. Rubs can have odor. Aspirin cream's different. Rubbing in aspirin cream relieves minor arthritis pain fast. No side effects, no odor. Aspirin cream, pain relief without aspirin.
Freude, schöne Güte, Funkentochter aus Elysium. Wir betreten Feuerrungen.
The all-aluminum Audi A8. Developed with Alcoa, it's the first premium luxury sedan with a 10-star safety rating.
I'm not seeing NASA. We need to see NASA TV up here, please.
You can see,
All right. Miles O'Brien back live at the Kennedy Space Center. And there's the man of the moment, Senator John Glenn, who is getting his harnesses on, his launch and reentry suit in the White Room at the entrance to the Space Shuttle Discovery. A difficult proposition for a person, I suppose, of any age. I suppose at the age of 77, the limberness isn't quite there. It's kind of difficult getting these suits, isn't it?
Well, I think my inclination would be about that point is to warn them not to break something.
All right, we are going to listen right now to NASA television, and the commentator is astronaut Rick Lenahan, and he'll explain what's going on with the suit technicians and John Glenn.
To have Senator Glenn getting back into the orbiter, and they're the lucky guys who get to be part of that history this morning by being a suit tech and strapping him in. And I know they're really excited about that. We were talking about it last night in the White Room, and great opportunity.
Hi, is that TRP-12?
Yes, sir. You have a go on step 571 to load new tapes.
Copy.
CBSE, OTC.
All right, those suit technicians helping with the fit on that suit. It's basically a rubber suit with a,
and
you know,
they're adjusting.
Listen to Rick Lenahan here for a minute.
Launch and entry suit here, these ACE suit, making sure the parachute harnesses are up. You can see the blue pad behind the harness for comfort. And you just saw them put in a couple of psyllium sticks into his suit. We talked about those before for visibility.
Harness, that's not actually the parachute.
He's pretty happy.
And the parachute is actually already on the seat, and they strap themselves in a 5-point restraint once they get inside.
You can see the neck rings right now. You've got those two little orange tabs with the white elastic bands coming out, and they're just Velcro tabs that will come out. Because this is a pressure suit, you really have a tight fit around your neck. It's like a neoprene turtleneck, almost like a surf suit that goes around your neck. And those bands actually will pull that out away from your neck when you're not configured with a helmet on, to give you a little more comfort and allow more air exchange inside the suit. It helps.
The suit's quite a bit different than the first suit that he wore back 36 years ago. That was a silver suit.
Yeah, but that silver suit is classic. I mean, when you think about spacemen and spacesuits and all that, you think to the early days, and you think about the early suits of Mercury and Apollo suits that they wore. And it's amazing the technology and how far it's come in terms of the suits. But yet, the amazing thing is that the technology back then is that they came up with that in a very short period of time, and it worked, and it worked well. And so they were able to build in that technology over the years, and much of that technology that we have from the military and NASA has been applied today to suits such as this in a lot of different areas of, say, fire rescue, EMT, things like that. And so NASA technology has trickled down in a lot of ways you don't really think about, and one of those ways would be the spacesuit.
Yes, Juan, I leave you.
And Gunter Wendt, you had a point. Go ahead.
I tend to
think, though, that the senator's suit is even harder to put on than this one, and that's when you're in space to put the EVA suit on with all the connections and so on, because that is a really cumbersome suit. Even in weightlessness, it floats, but just getting in and getting it on is even very, very tricky.
Course, that's in essence a form-fitting spaceship. And it's got all of the support equipment of the spaceship.
As a matter of fact, I'm frequently asked, you know, what if they are on EVA and they have to use the bathroom? Have you ever asked the question? Do you know what happened?
We've all heard that question, yes.
Everybody asked that question about astronauts.
Okay, and,
yes, I mean, that used to be in the early days in Apollo. Why didn't we have a female astronaut? You know, and the simple answer was we couldn't come up with a urine collection system for the female astronauts. Now, these astronauts actually on EVAs, they wear Pampers. And even now, for liftoff, they do.
Something Linehan said just a moment ago there as we watched this. He said something that reminded me of how long ago February 1962 was when Glenn made his first flight. I was looking through my notes. I found this explanation of the material that covered the inside of the hatch of Friendship 7. This is a quote. This is what I said on the air. It's an ingenious kind of material, thousands of tiny loops, various things that Glenn must handle, camera, notebook, things like that, have a piece of material on them that is really thousands of tiny hooks. He just has to put his camera against the hatch and it stays there. The hooks engage the loops. It probably wouldn't work on Earth. Boy, probably wouldn't work on Earth, but in the weightlessness of space, this stuff keeps things from floating around the capsule.
Right.
Talking about Velcro, for goodness sakes, and that was just 36 years ago.
I know.
Probably wouldn't work on Earth. That's why I didn't invest in it.
Walter, you should have bought the stock right then and there.
I know. That was a great thing. We were learning as we went along, and we made many mistakes, but nobody knew, just like we were talking about man or machine. And we had to make provisions to have a machine which could do it in case a man couldn't do it. So we actually designed a dual machine, you know, go automatic or go with men. Because remember, Walter, they were talking about that the eyeballs would fly out and he couldn't lift his arms or he couldn't do anything. And so we had to find out step by step what can be done.
This is what made that first flight of Glenn's the dramatic flight it was.
Yes.
We didn't know what was going to happen to him up there. The Russians had a couple of people up in orbit, but they weren't sharing their information with us. We didn't know what they were like when they got there.
Plus, the Russians used them more or less as passengers. They never had them control anything, you know, in the beginning.
You know, it's probably worth pointing out here, and maybe we can get somebody to bring the models on the set here for just a moment, but let's compare the two spacecraft for a moment, if you will. The difference is quite staggering, isn't it? In size, it is there was 36 cubic feet of size inside that Mercury capsule. Now, what we have on the set here is a model which shows the space shuttle with its external fuel tank and its solid rocket boosters beside a Mercury capsule sitting on top an Atlas rocket. And these two things are the same scale. And I think, as you can see over here, the Mercury Atlas stack would, you could probably almost fit 1.5 inside that solid rocket booster.
Well, and the power of this thing compared to this, this was 7 million pounds thrust.
Yes.
This was, what, 36,000, wasn't it?
Yeah, 360,000.
360,000.
So big thrust differences, and then the key, I suppose, that the big difference that John Glenn is going to feel, besides that punch of acceleration he's going to feel, presumably, if the launch goes on schedule, is the space. He had 36 cubic feet in the Mercury capsule and more than 2,000 cubic feet to float around in the space shuttle. It's a big difference. He never really got the full feel.
And if you put the redstone here, the
that's little, even smaller.
Little firecracker that took Shepard and Carpenter on. It would be about like
Shepard
this.
And that is that, and plus another fact is you got to understand, when Glenn went, he experienced as much as 7 Gs. Now we are limited to 3 Gs, so they don't even get that much stress as they used to be in the olden days. And I remember, whenever you wanted to do something in the Mercury spacecraft, you had to lean into the hatch, and most of the stuff was underneath the seat or someplace where you couldn't get to it. It was rather complicated to even get equipment in at these times. So it was a really tight fit.
Well, you know,
is it time to repeat? Excuse me.
Go ahead. No, you go ahead, Walter.
Is it time to repeat the story that I have often told to Shiraw, told me when I asked him once after his flight? I said, come on, you guys get back and at the White House and all these appearances you're making now, you tell about your confidence in this craft that you went up in. Come on, Wally, now that we're having a beer here together, tell me what you were really thinking when you were lying there on that couch about to be blasted off with this little rocket. And Wally said, well, you promise you won't ever tell anybody this? So I can't tell you. I'm sorry. No, time enough has passed, I'll tell you. He said, well, you know what I really thought? He said, I looked at all those switches, those knobs, those things to turn on and off. And I thought to myself, my gosh, just think, this thing was built by the lowest bidder.
I know. That was the story they always gave us, you know, built by the lowest bidder.
Yes.
But, you know, one interesting thing too, Walter, was like in the Mercury spacecraft, if you got the signal that the range officer was going to destruct the booster, you had manually to eject yourself, I mean the capsule, from there, and you had to throw 7 switches. And it always was an interesting thing who was the fastest to throw these switches in the right sequence. So one day I practiced it too, and I did a real neat job, except the moment I had the escape rocket take us off, I discarded the parachute, which was a little detrimental to recovery, well, but Shepard was the fastest.
Yeah, speaking of man in the loop, and speaking of Wally Schirra, he had the occasion with Gemini.
Oh, yes.
Of that shutdown in the last second right on the pad.
Yeah.
He handled that with perfectly, exactly what he should have done at that moment he did.
And that is...
It could have been fatal.
I know. That is where the training comes in, you know, where you really know what you're doing. He was listening, as a matter of fact. Is there anything going on? Is the thing breaking up? Is it catching fire and so on? While he had hands on the escape handle.
All right, gentlemen, I'm sorry, we've got to take a break right now. You're looking at Scott Perezinski in the White Room, getting ready to have his appointment with the suit technicians. John Glenn is pretty well tucked away, just about complete on that. We're going to continue our extensive coverage of the launch of Discovery in just a moment. Stay with CNN.
Freude, schöne Güte, Funkentochter aus Elysium.
The all-aluminum Audi A8. Developed with Alcoa, it's the first premium luxury sedan with a 10-star safety rating. No wonder everyone's singing its praise.
You don't have to be president of the United States, or a superstar athlete, or a comic book superhero to be the most important person in the world to somebody. At Cigna, we offer life, accident, and disability insurance, so you can take care of and protect your family. But isn't that what being a superhero is all about? Cigna, a business of caring.
still have your pay stubs from your college job?
Why would they need that?
You never know.
At Countrywide Home Loans, we've put our branch managers in charge of the entire home loan process.
I could sure use those statements.
Still looking.
We have no loan committee.
Hiya, just checking in again.
Peter, I think I have everything I need from you.
It's okay. I don't want to rush the loan committee.
I am the loan committee.
What?
Your loan is approved.
That was quick.
Countrywide. Easy. Really.
I have astigmatism, and I've tried everything to get rid of these darn glasses. I want soft contacts, but I've always been told if I want to see clearly, I'm stuck with these. Not anymore. Now there's Focus, the soft contacts made for people with astigmatism. And if you call this number, you can get a sample pair of Focus free. With Focus, I see great, crisp and clear, and I'm not always stuck in glasses. So bring your life into Focus. Call now for your free trial certificate.
Back live for coverage at the Kennedy Space Center, a picture-perfect blue sky, a gentle light breeze, the American flag flying beneath it, the flag of the Space Shuttle Discovery. To the right, the countdown clock. 1 hour, 48 minutes, 54 seconds, and counting. We do expect two more holds this afternoon before we have an expected launch at 2 p.m. There'll be a hold at 20 minutes. That will be a 10-minute hold. Then there'll be a hold at 9 minutes, which will also be a 10-minute hold. And there is also possibility of another hold relating to a problem with a sensor. We can get into that a little bit more later. Not a real problem whatsoever, just a little workaround for NASA. The bottom line, these holds give everybody an opportunity to stay on schedule as they continue toward the launch of Discovery. John Glenn aboard, Walter Cronkite, Gunter Wendt, who spent years and years in the white rooms of these launch stanchions all along the coast here, all the way down Cape Canaveral, joining us, and we're watching the crew come aboard. It's amazing how smoothly things have run, Walter, compared to 36 years ago. Big difference, huh?
Yep. By this time, we would have had a couple of scrubs, anyway.
Yes, we had the launch was actually the 11th attempt that we made, you know, from scheduling. But, see, John was also the guy who gave me the name as a pad Führer. Have you ever heard that?
What?
The pad Führer. Pad Führer.
Yeah, he said I resembled somebody that he knew from history that was somewhat dictatorial. And I never thought I was dictatorial. I told John, I said, I'm not a dictator. Just do what I tell you. You have no problem. And then later on, Pete Conrad asked once, he explained to Neil Armstrong how to get along with me. He says, just do what he tells you and you have no problem. And Neil says, well, what can he do if I just throw a switch? Pete said, oh, nothing. He steps on your fingers.
Gunter, were you one of the Peenemunde?
No, I was a little bit too young for that. I knew about him, you know, but I came over in 49.
Uh-huh.
And the first 5 years, I couldn't even work in aerospace because I wasn't a citizen.
Yeah.
And but then after that, I hired in at McDonald's, mm-hmm. and then later on got into the Mercury program right away.
Sure, sure.
So that was very enjoyable.
Yeah.
But did you ever talk about that story? Remember Walt Williams used to be the NASA chief engineer in his Corvette story?
Yeah, right.
Have you ever heard that story? I imagine your dad Walter may have told you about it. One day we were on the pad and Shepard was there with Grissom. Yeah, with Grissom. And Walt Williams had a press conference and he didn't have a car. So he very bravely said to Walt, he said, oh, go ahead and take my Corvette. And Walt says, you don't mind, do you? And they said, no, no, go ahead, take it. So here, Walt goes down, jumps in the Corvette, and Alan's, I always watch him, he stood at the window, he picked up the phone, he called security, he says, hey, some SOB just took my car from the pad, he's heading for the South Gate. Now, when Williams showed up at the South Gate, four Husky guys didn't even ask the question. They pulled him out of this Corvette. A long story short, Williams didn't talk to Shepard for 4 weeks.
All right, let's listen in to the comm checks on board Discovery as they check out their communications gear for just a moment. That's a great shot.
And you
right
can
there.
See that MS-2, Scott, is positioning himself. This is a great shot because it shows all of them, and you're looking straight down. Scott sits between the PLT and the CDR, the pilot and commander, as the flight engineer, MS-2. And this is a very demanding position. Scott, in addition to his payload duties and his medical duties, had to train and study very long and hard to acquire the knowledge and skills that he needs to function as the MS-2 flight engineer, because he in some ways needs to know as much as both the pilot and commander in some ways together, because he monitors everything from the back and actually watches what they do, and kind of is a reminder guide to them about different procedures that will need to be accomplished. And
and just to orient you folks, that camera is mounted right on the center of the cockpit and facing right down at Scott Perzinski, the flight engineer. We're back down in the mid-deck now. In the foreground, Jacques Mukai. In the middle, Senator John Glenn. In the far end of the picture there, the man they call Juan Glenn, Pedro Duque, all of them getting strapped in, and the suit techs hovering around them, hooking them up properly. And I need to correct something I misspoke earlier. The parachutes are actually included on that harness. They're not on the seat, as we had reported earlier. Just to clarify that point, in the interest of accuracy,
you know, Miles, you have mentioned it several times before, but I think it's worth mentioning again now that we see that picture. They might as well be locked into a hotel room somewhere as far as seeing anything on the flight, on the launch, that is. We'll listen to again.
Make sure they're cinched down properly.
Well, it's interesting.
Having his watch put on his wrist, getting all his personal equipment done the way he wants it.
They have no windows in the mid-flight deck there that they can see out of on launch. What they really feel like more than anything is being in the locker room of some athletic club.
Yes, once they are in orbit, they can get up. I mean, they have the window at the hatch. But that's about the only thing. But Walt, you have been in the spacecraft, and I remember when we did the approach and landing test on the shuttle, I once counted switches, and I found out if you are in the commander's seat and there was one of the design requirements, you would have to be able to see, touch, or manipulate 1,642 switches, controls, or gauges.
Isn't that something?
1,642.
Yes, that's all that you had to be able, while you were strapped in, to operate, or see, or read.
Well, let's go through some of the comparisons here. Friendship 7, the Mercury capsule, which took John Glenn into orbit 36 years ago, had 143 display components in the cockpit. Discovery has a total, Gunter, of 2,312.
Yes.
Complicated machine. Friendship 7 had 56 toggle switches. Discovery, 856. Friendship 7, 8 push button switches. Discovery, 219. Friendship 7 with 19 event indicators. Discovery, 559 event indicators. That's a lot of events in space, isn't it?
I think you learn real quick, like, that you learn to, if you are a pilot, to scan all the instruments in a certain fashion. Normally you go from left to right, and you know, when you fly, you scan and see what all is there. And it was always a battle when I went to Downey, when we built shuttle and so on. I always complained. I said, I don't like digital indicators because it takes another brain action to interpret.
Precisely.
I always like the indicator that show you a position. You can look at it if the pointer
analog
is like this.
You want to see an arrow up there.
Analog gauges versus digital. Digital, you always have to interpret. Your brain needs extra time to do that.
You know, I found that out in sailing on the boat. I try desperately these days to get an analog clock-like face instead of the digital. You're right. The digital, you've got to focus on and register that number. With the arrow, you look at it, you know instantly that it's 6 feet or 8 feet or 10 feet or you're going 40 or whatever. You know, it's a much different business.
All right, it is time for us to take a break. Gunter Wendt, it was such a pleasure having you in with us. We're going to say goodbye to you now. Well, we know you have a busy day on
hand. See you another 10 years from now, right?
Great to see you again. Wonderful to see you again.
Thank you.
All right, CNN's continuing coverage of the launch of Discovery will continue in just a moment. Please stay with us.
My little thing.
Today, join Miles O'Brien and Walter Cronkite for an exclusive interview with President Clinton moments before John Glenn's historic launch, only on CNN.
Sorry I'm late.
Tell your dad the wedding's on me.
Still not done, but we'll finish it for free.
Wouldn't it be nice if everything were guaranteed like Cox Cable Service? Because we're on time for installations or they're free. And we're on time for service appointments, or you get a $20 credit on your bill.
Sorry, I was late. Here's $20.
that everything's not guaranteed like Cox Cable Service.
You hunger for the outdoors. You thirst for adventure. Your heart quickens to the call of the wild. You just need to know where to begin. Lou Webb's Volvo Irvine in the Irvine Auto Center. The adventure begins here.
Freedom Village Continuing Care Retirement Community and Skilled Nursing and Assisted Living Center in Lake Forest is the ideal place for older adults to enjoy a wonderful life, where friendships grow, where service excels, where peace of mind is yours, where worries about health care disappear, where life is good. For the best in retirement living and health care for yourself or an older family member, call for your free brochure and video. Call Freedom Village today at 1-800-584-8084.
It's dangerous, and when it gets into our air and water, it's deadly. But Matt Fong says our clean air and water laws are too tough. He says they're unreasonable. He says the food safety and environmental standards that protect our kids from pesticides are too burdensome. Fong even wants to build a nuclear waste dump that scientists warn could leak into the water supply for millions of Californians. Matt Fong, he's wrong about toxics and nuclear waste, and wrong for California.
Back live at the Kennedy Space Center, you're looking at the middeck of the Space Shuttle Discovery. Shiaki Mukai in the foreground, John Glenn in the middle, Pedro Duque in the background there, two suit technicians, contractors and or NASA employees helping them get into their suits, check out their communications gear, make sure they're comfortable, buttoned in, and ready for orbit. I'm joined here by Walter Cronkite. We've been talking all day about then and now and the differences, and the space on board this shuttle is truly remarkable compared to, as you put it, the insertion of an astronaut some 36 years ago. Yeah. Big difference, isn't it?
Called it inserting them, which they did. They slid them through that little tiny hatch and right into the seat that's been built for them. It was an insertion, hardly. They didn't walk in like they do today.
Not for the claustrophobic, certainly. No. All right, we're joined by another guest this afternoon, Dave Wolf, who is a NASA astronaut. Great to see you, Dave.
He had to insert himself in the Mir.
He spent 4.5 months on the Russian space station Mir. He's back firmly on terra firma and joining us to help us talk about how they're getting ready for launch. Dave, great to have you here. So far,
pleasure.
So good. Everything seems to be going smoothly.
We should have said Drosvichy.
Drosvichy, конечно, of course.
Or pass the canned perch, maybe. I don't know which. But
canned
tell me,
perch, yes.
how are things going from your view of things?
I don't think we could have a smoother launch count. The weather's essentially perfect. This is as good as it gets. Let's just keep our finger crossed. It stays good to a 2 o'clock on-time launch.
You know, it's actually, I don't know. I don't know the statistics. You tell me. How unusual is it to have a perfectly flawless countdown?
Well, actually, we've had... if you look at the paper, things like a light bulb or something that's not important, a few ground pieces of equipment that have showed minor errors, it's not absolutely 100% flawless, nothing of any concern toward the launch whatsoever. But this is as good as it gets. I'd say 1 in 3 is this clean.
Really? That's pretty remarkable. Now, we're looking at a shot here.
Keep our fingers crossed.
We're striving for 100%. Now, this is just exceptionally good.
There's a whole lot of
hard to beat.
And now this shot right here, which is coming at you from the top of the cockpit, looking down. To the right, we have Commander Kurt Brown. To the left of your screen, pilot Steve Lindsay. Right in the middle, Scott Perezinski, the flight engineer. Sitting beside him is Steve Robinson, who... now, we know we were just talking a few moments ago about Scott Perezinski's role as the flight engineer, a critical role,
right,
monitoring
critical
systems.
Role.
He can see a lot of instruments that the pilot and the commander cannot. What will Steve Robinson be doing on the ascent?
On the ascent, Steve Robinson will be, he has a good view of the three CRTs, cathode ray tubes, essentially display units that are in front of the three people you see very clearly there, the main CRTs on the instruments. And he'll be monitoring systems. He has his own eye trained on particular parameters, such as, is the purge helium that clears the explosive gases from the seals in the main engine so they don't back up into the engine, is that pressure maintained? That's very critical, and he'll have his eye on parameters such as that.
Now, as we look at that suit technician, now it's high. We once again have to orient ourselves. It's like being in a fun house or something. But the bottom line is the suit technician is standing on what would be an instrument panel,
right?
Which would be normally upright. What do they do to protect those instruments, Dave?
That's right. There's a set of platforms. Now, that's an ascent support person, and I can't see who it is here, but likely one of our astronauts. Two of them would be helping at this point in time. But there's a set of panels made to fit that part of the cockpit. Now, it looks like the floor. We're looking straight down, but really that's the back wall of the cockpit, looking back into the payload bay of the orbiter. Now, those doors of the payload bay will open almost immediately upon getting into orbit.
All right, now we're going to break away from our anchor position for a moment because John Zarella is somewhere on the compound with a couple of people who have some interesting demonstrations for us. Spacesuits then and now, we'll call it. John?
That's right, Miles. We're just talking about the closeout crew, and we have here with us Ray Villalobos. And Ray is one of the members of the closeout crew. And Ray, you've got the modern-day spacesuit on here. This is what the astronauts, the launch and reentry suit, they'd be wearing today with that helmet, correct?
Correct. This is the suit that John Glenn will be flying today.
We were a little concerned about how hot you'd be out here in this. You're okay?
I'm very well, very comfortable.
Now, I want to break away just for a second and give you a look at what this is. The suit, this is a test suit that Gus Grissom would have worn about 38 years ago. And Stephanie Walker is here. And Stephanie, you design spacesuits, the old and the new. And your job is to make sure we keep up with the latest trends and the development of suits?
That's right. We work at Johnson Space Center. I work with Ray on the development of the launch and entry suits. I also work with the group that does the EVA spacesuits, or the white spacesuit. We're all in the same group.
What have been some of the major innovations, besides color, in the last 38 years?
Well, the first thing you notice is, of course, the color. The old suit was an aluminum-coated nylon and rubber suit, and that was so that the heat from reentry would be reflected away from the body. We now are going to a bright orange suit because the suit is primarily an emergency rescue suit. So if the crew should have to bail out of the shuttle, this bright orange shows up very well out in the ocean. And it also has all the survival gear incorporated into the suit instead of in a separate pack, so they can actually parachute out and survive on their own.
So everything is all self-contained as opposed to what they used to have to go through.
Right.
So John Glenn would probably be a lot more comfortable in the suit he's in today than the one he would have worn 38 years ago, or no?
Yes, in some ways, and no in others. The safety is improved, but the old Mercury suits were custom made for the astronauts. They're built specifically to their dimensions. And John even mentioned that if you gained weight or lost weight or built up muscles, they had to rebuild the suit because of it. We no longer custom make suits. We have 12 sizes, and we adjust the suit to fit the crew members. We can take up their arms and legs within those sizes.
I want to thank both of you very much for taking time. I know Ray wanted to chat with you. You are a member of the closeout crew. A lot of times, Ray would be out there, Miles, actually the last man to see the astronauts before they close the door. That's Ray's job out at the pad. This is John Zarella reporting live. Back to you, Miles.
All right. Thank you very much, John. We appreciate that little demonstration. We're back up at the closeout room, the white room, and it looks like they're getting ready. Dave Wolf, tell me what they're doing there right now. It looks like they're taking some kind of seal off. I don't know, maybe you missed it, but nevertheless, they're getting ready. The preparation is getting underway for closing the hatch. How soon will that
happen? That's right. Those technicians are standing in the white room. They're preparing. The door will close. They have to make sure there are no loose objects in this area, that the seal around that hatch is perfectly clean. There's an O-ring there, a red O-ring going all the way around. That has to be absolutely airtight, of course, once we're in orbit. This whole white room will retract in the 10 minutes or so, 20 minutes before the launch. We'll hear that later. And it will undergo a lot of stress. We have to make sure no objects can come loose in there.
So, you know, folks, it's like a jetway, sort of, shuttle.
Exactly, right. Well put.
All right, let's go to the World Wide Web if we can for a moment. CNN.com/Glenn is a great place to stay up to date on this launch and learn more about it. One of the things we have on here are these IPEX pictures. Take a look at this, Dave. This and Walter. This is a 360-degree view of the cockpit. This is actually a shuttle simulator in Houston where this was shot. You can look up, you can look down, and you can look around. And Walter, we had a little simulator run not too long ago. It's a pretty impressive piece of machinery, isn't it?
Oh, indeed it is. You can't believe the complexity of it, of course. The number of switches, the number of readouts, the number of the monitoring equipment. It's baffling that anybody can master it to the degree that they can respond to an emergency situation, let alone fly the thing. Flying it to a landing is something, isn't it? They come down at a 20-degree angle as opposed to...
Twice as steep as the steepest jet approaches and the fastest landing aircraft that there is, glider particularly. But it takes a whole team, as you say. No one person really can master every bit of the orbiter and the payloads. And that's why we fly seven-person teams, and this is a world of specialty now to some degree.
And it would be, I think we'd be derelict if we didn't mention that in front of every space station, including the pilot and the command pilot, there is a whole book of instructions as to what to do in case of emergency.
Exactly.
Turn to very quickly the instructions in case you slip a cog at the right moment.
Now, the International Space Station raises this to an even further degree. It's much bigger yet, with even more systems and payloads to operate and less time to train per unit time in flight.
Yeah.
So we have to overcome that through training on board.
We're back in the white room right now as they continue their final preparations. And I do want to show folks the mid-deck on that same technology, that IPEX 360 degrees. This is the view that John Glenn will see on his ride uphill, as astronauts call it. Nothing but a bunch of lockers, right, Dave?
Well, it may look that way in this picture, but in the real orbiter, those lockers are replaced by scientific experiments, very complex gear. Inside them is the essentials of both living and conducting the research on board.
And as you can see, his seat would be right in the middle there, right about where that looks like a stool or some part of a seat is. And you can come on to cnn.com/Glenn and find your way to this IPEX image and take your own self-guided tour of the space shuttle, the flight deck, and the mid-deck. Let's go back to some live pictures of what's going on Launch Pad 39B. And before we do that, however, we're going to take a quick break here as we continue our coverage of the launch of Discovery. We are now counting down 1 hour, 28 minutes, 17 seconds to launch. Stay with us.
John Glenn's Return to Space is brought to you by Lockheed Martin, the company that takes the most amazing ideas about the future and makes them fly. And by Quality Care Fall Value Days, now at participating Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers.
The U.S. Postal Service, with new automated systems from Lockheed Martin, is speeding the delivery of billions of pieces of mail and the occasional birthday present from Uncle Will. Interestingly, Lockheed Martin is also building America's next generation of fighter planes, which means we not only help deliver the present, but the future.
The right people, the right parts, the right prices. Quality Care Fall Value Days at participating Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers. For Ford, Mercury, or Lincoln cars, Motorcraft shocks are just $69 per pair installed. On Ford, light-duty trucks, just $99 per pair installed. For the care your vehicle deserves and the parts it needs, bring it to the folks who know it best.
At your service, Quality Care. I hope I see you there.
Tell the truth. Do you soak your dentures every day? No? Takes too long? Well, Polident works in just 5 minutes. So it's easy to clean every day. And that's what really helps control denture odor. Use 5-Minute Polident every day.
Right here, 30 years ago, on my first jump, I shattered the world's record by almost 2 feet. That day, everyone thought no man would ever jump further. Well, almost everyone. Because for some people, there's always room for improvement.
With the same determination, the men and women at Rhodia practice their profession as specialty chemists to improve your daily life. Rhodia, the best is yet to come.
3 years and $100 million putting in software for just-in-time manufacturing.
Yeah, so? The world's biggest, most profitable manufacturer just moved to something called flow manufacturing.
Switch to flow.
I can't.
$100 million in my software doesn't support it.
So, what software do the big guys use?
Oracle, the world's second largest software company, is the first with integrated flow manufacturing applications.
The big guys? I used to be a big guy.
It is now about an hour and 45 minutes to launch. You're looking at the scene from high above. The Goodyear blimp orbiting at a safe distance around the Kennedy Space Center. We're told about 12 miles away. That's about how much airspace they clear off for this aircraft. The Space Shuttle Discovery, scheduled now for liftoff in less than an hour and 45 minutes. And providing our coverage from above is the blimp Stars and Stripes at the controls, Captain Jim Maloney, from Vienna, Virginia. This year is Goodyear is celebrating its 100-year anniversary and 72-year anniversary for its blimp fleet. There is the Stars and Stripes, an appropriate name for a blimp on a day like today, I should say. Mark Potter is somewhere beneath the Goodyear blimp right now with the group on the beach, ready to see the show. Hello, Mark.
Hello, Miles. Well, we are in a sea of people, 8,000 people to be specific, here in Titusville. Everyone is just waiting quietly. People are hunkered down now. The excitement of early this morning has settled down a bit. People are just waiting for the launch at 2 o'clock. The main thing they're having to deal with here right now is the heat. It's a very hot day, and everyone is just doing what they can to keep cool. Umbrellas are precious commodities, as you can see here in this area right now, which looks like a beachhead. Actually, it is sort of one. We're on the bank of the Indian River, about 10 miles from the launch pad area, and surprisingly 10 miles away we can still see the pad. We can certainly see the vehicle assembly building. It's going to be quite a show here, and everyone knows that, and they're just waiting for the time to pass so that they can watch it. And we're being kept apprised here by a loudspeaker system over the hill of exactly how things are going, so people know where we stand and how much more time we have to go. Now, people are here from all over the country. And in fact, we met a couple here from Sydney, Australia. They came here just for this launch. Some of the people who are here from this country include Gary Thompson. Gary, we tried to talk to you earlier, but we were interrupted by the astronauts. You came all the way from Perryville, Maryland. Tell me why you thought it was so important to be here.
Well, just a history. I went to see John Glenn go back up in space again.
And what's so important about this mission as far as you're concerned?
Well, I think it's going to give a boost to the space program that, for further funding and whatnot. I just think that the space program needs a shot in the arm right now.
And this will do it?
I believe so. You see the people here.
Exactly. Alice and Bob Wills are here from Cleveland, Ohio, the state where Senator Glenn is from.
Right.
Tell me why you thought it was so important to come here for this.
Well, we wanted to represent our city, which is a space town with NASA there and also a great city to live, and our family and our church from Grace Baptist, and Glenn has always been real special to us.
And so what do you think about seeing him return to space 36 years later?
I think it's fantastic. I just admire a man that's 77 that can actually go back to where he's been and just be really important to his country.
And Bob, what do you think about the importance of this to the country itself?
Well, it's the first one I've ever seen live, and I'm really going to enjoy that. But John's kind of special to us, and we'd like to see him go up the second time. I saw him on TV go up the first time. And you kind of look at somebody else and it was over. So this one, he's really going to enjoy going up.
And there's been some controversy about this flight. Some people are critical, saying that the science is not real science, that it's just a pretext for a nostalgic visit back. What do you think about that?
Well,
or does it matter?
I really don't know whether that's true or not, but I know what does matter, and that is John is getting everybody all excited again about going up to space. And that's what NASA's whole program needed, is a kind of a shot in the arm of the people getting back into it. So I think if nothing else, that is a real value.
Well, we appreciate talking with all of you. Enjoy the show. It's going to be quite some show here. We're going to have a good view right over here to the left of the VAB, the vehicle assembly building, and we're all looking forward to it. Again, a crowd of 8,000 people here, an estimated crowd of 250,000 to 300,000 in the entire Brevard County area here watching this event. Miles, back to you.
All right, Mark Potter enjoying himself out there. Once again, a spectacular view on a spectacular day from the Goodyear blimp as we look at Florida Space Ghost in preparation for the launch of Discovery. Six people and a seventh by the name of John Glenn, his second historic flight into space. is now an hour and 20 minutes away if things go according to plan. Stay with CNN for extensive live coverage of this event. We'll take a break right now and we'll go back to Atlanta and check in on what's going on in the rest of the world.
We all have dreams, but the world is full of risk. And we wonder, go ahead. Go ahead with a world leader in insurance and investment. Go ahead. Go ahead with a group that manages $500 billion in assets. Go ahead. We will help you reach your financial goals. AXA, represented by the Equitable Companies.
Freude, schöne Güte, Funken, Tochter aus Elysium. Wir betreten
the all-aluminum Audi A8. Developed with Alcoa, it's the first premium luxury sedan with a 10-star safety rating. No wonder everyone's singing its praise.
We were on vacation in New Orleans. Great city. But every night, I got this awful heartburn. A woman in our tour group said, here, try Zantac 75. Oh, thank you, I said. You're a saint. She said, no, actually, I'm a doctor.
The medicine in Zantac 75 is the number one doctor-prescribed acid reducer. It relieves even your toughest heartburn, controlling acid for up to 12 hours.
Maybe a doctor and a saint.
Zantac 75, the final word in heartburn relief.
When was the last time you felt the power of a mountain, the romance of a train, or the unexpected warmth of a stranger's smile? When was the last time you spotted orcas at play, or remembered how to spell Aurora Borealis? And when was the last time you felt so inspired by the simple act of looking out your window? Holland, America, it's time.
Hi, I'm Jean Meserve in Washington. We'll be going back to Florida shortly for our coverage of the launch of the shuttle Discovery. But first, a look at some other news. Hurricane Mitch has lost much of its ferocity, but is still punishing the Central American coast. Heavy rains continue to cause flooding in Guatemala, Belize, and Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula. But Honduras has sustained the worst damage. Up to 100,000 people have been evacuated from coastal areas and islands offshore. Mitch's winds have diminished to 75 miles per hour. Forecasters say the storm will remain a threat, though, for several more days. The Palestinian Authority has placed Sheikh Ahmed Yassin, the spiritual leader of the militant Hamas movement, under house arrest following today's bloody suicide bombing in the Gaza Strip, for which Hamas had claimed responsibility. An Israeli jeep escorting a school bus full of children was rammed by a car loaded with explosives near a block of Jewish settlements in southern Gaza. An Israeli soldier and the attacker were killed. Seven other people were injured. The attack came less than a week after the latest Israeli-Palestinian peace deal. Palestinian Authority President Yasser Arafat has pledged to find those responsible. The Israelis say Arafat must crack down on terror, but stress the attack won't stop implementation of the peace agreement.
Then we have to be strong enough to continue the peace process and to fight against the terror. I hope that the Palestinians understand how dangerous it is now, and they are going to operate to do everything that's necessary against the terror.
Israeli hardliners have been pressing Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to call off the Land for Security peace deal. Some other international stories we're following in our Newsday notes. Blame spread all around in the controversial report delivered today by South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission. The panel condemned the former white-ruled government, but also found the African National Congress responsible for human rights abuses during the apartheid era. Former military ruler Augusto Pinochet was moved to another hospital in London today, but remains under arrest. Britain's High Court ruled yesterday that he is immune from Spanish attempts to extradite him on genocide and torture charges. An appeal is pending. Fire that ripped through a construction site in South Korea killed more than 20 workers today. More than a dozen others were injured, some by jumping from the building. Flooding brought by heavy rain is challenging authorities and residents of Germany. Some areas are declared disaster zones with immersed roads, uprooted trees, and mudslides reported. And now we're going to take a break.
Today, join Miles O'Brien and Walter Cronkite for an exclusive interview with President Clinton moments before John Glenn's historic launch, only on CNN.
Sorry I'm late.
Tell your dad the wedding's on me.
Still not done, but we'll finish it for free.
Wouldn't it be nice if everything were guaranteed like Cox Cable Service? Because we're on time for installations or they're free. And we're on time for service appointments or you get a $20 credit on your bill.
Sorry, I was late. Here's 20 bucks.
Too bad everything's not guaranteed like Cox Cable Service.
The automotive sale of the season from a dealership known for its spectacular savings events. It's Lou Webb's Irvine Toyota Factory Authorized Clearance Sale.
Factory to dealer incentives can save you thousands and super low, low finance.
Plus, Camrys under $16,000, Forerunners under $20,000, Corollas under $12,000.
And a massive selection of Toyota certified pre-owned vehicles.
All at the Irvine Toyota Factory Authorized Clearance Sale. In the Irvine Auto Center.
CNN Today with Lou Waters and Natalie Allen. Weekdays on CNN.
And now we're going to take a look at the weather to Rose Stabler in Atlanta now. Rose?
Well, Gene, of course, the all-important weather today, of course, besides the hurricane, is the launch weather at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Daylight time today, or Eastern Standard Time. I forgot we're back into daylight saving time. Anyway, partly cloudy, 84 with light winds, and that's very important. Winds out of the northeast at 5 to 10 miles an hour. Now, should something go wrong, we do have abort sites all around the world, and the weather is looking good at all of these areas. Edwards Air Force Base in Southern California is experiencing some gusty winds, but other than that, everything's looking pretty nice as far as the weather goes. And I'll have more on the launch site weather as well as the hurricane. Back to you, Gene.
Rose, thanks a lot. And we will have more on the launch of the shuttle Discovery in just a moment.
All right. We're back live at the Kennedy Space Center, and you're up in the white room, as they call it, which is the gangway which leads to the shuttle entrance, which is now being sealed shut. Dave Wolf, this is an important procedure. I recall a mission not too long ago where they had some difficulty with the seal here. It's very important that this be leak checked and properly fitted onto its where it belongs before anybody blasts off, right?
That's right. It's critical. And now that the hatch is closed, the ground crew that we see there will be installing a fitting to pump the pressure up in the vehicle. All the vent valves will be closed during this check, and we'll do a leak check and look at make sure that pressure is held by the vehicle. When it's declared successful, then they'll finish closing out this white room and leave the area.
Can you identify any of these people here?
Those are people that I've worked with for a number of years on various missions, and they're the most talented workforce in the world, the people at Kennedy Space Center.
You have utter confidence. I guess you have to have a lot of confidence in the people who are preparing such a complex aircraft.
That's right. You can't pre-flight your own airplane in this case. You're trusting the work of thousands of people. A space station will be the same way. And it's just a wonderful team. It's really the brings out the best in a lot of people.
Dave, well, if I'm curious, this question is the question you probably answer quite often, but I'll ask it anyway. When you're at this point and that hatch seals shut and you're in your suit and you're basically the only communication you have is via radio, you're kind of shut off from the world, is it, are there moments when it is scary? That,
you know, scary isn't what I felt. There's a certain calmness and peacefulness. You've trained for years for these missions, and it's time to go do it. You've got on your mind what you're about to do. It's a very busy set of activities. As soon as you obtain orbit, 0 to 18,000 miles an hour in 8.5 minutes, or a little shy of 18,000. It's a spectacular ride. You're hoping everything goes right, but it's more of a hope and a calmness and anticipation.
You know, and I think it's important to point out here that really what astronauts are thinking about probably is really the minutia of their jobs right now. In other words, what do I do if, when, right?
Well, they've practiced this sequence, this ascent sequence, many hundreds of times. It's almost automatic for most situations, but you're wondering, will there be a situation we have not anticipated, that we have not practiced for? And that's a hard situation to run over in your head because you don't know what it is. If we'd thought about it, we'd have practiced.
Exactly. Now, it looks like the gentleman right by the door there has what appears to be some sort of pressure gauge, and I assume that's what
checks
the leaks.
That's right. There's gauges inside the orbiter. There's telemetry to the control center, and there's a fitting that he will actually pump up the pressure through.
It's probably worth pointing out here, too, that in the some of the worst-case scenarios, that hatch is designed to blow out, and out would extend a 10-foot-long pole. And the astronauts, in a situation where multiple engine loss, for example, might actually have to bail out. Why don't you walk us through the procedures you have to go through on getting out of an orbiter, extending that pole, and bailing out? How would that work?
That's right. Well, the first thing is the vehicle must be within parameters where successful bailout can occur, and that is some sort of controlled gliding flight. And therefore, on ascent, you have to start the return home, at least. If you're not going to make your landing site, if you're going to go long, or if you're going to go short, or in the ocean, then we like to get down to around 20,000 feet, although the system is capable up to 100,000 feet for a bailout, since the astronauts are wearing pressure suits. The MS-3 sitting in that seat will pull the set of handles that blows the hatch. Before that, the pressure will be equalized by the commander controlling the vent valves. The system will be put on an attitude hold, a kind of an autopilot, to get ready for all seven crew members to take their turns coming out. You'll clip on a fitting to this pole, and this pole makes sure that at these high speeds you don't come back and hit the tail of the orbiter. It pulls you down below the tail of the orbiter. Each one diving out in sequence, hopefully very quickly. And there should be time. In the case of a water ditch, water flotation equipment comes out with you, raft, life preserver.
All right, I gotta interrupt that for just a moment. The President of the United States has arrived. Let's look at some pictures here. There he is, Patrick Air Force Base, about 10 miles due south of where we are now, walking off of Air Force One. Dave, the last time a president was here, Apollo 12, I asked Alan Bean about this earlier. They launched into a thunderstorm. And of course, many have suggested over the years that the pressure of having the president here somehow skewed the decision. What do folks at NASA think of that?
Well, I know I can only speak for NASA today. We have safety foremost in our mind. We have strict flight rules for these conditions. We have a set of what are called field mills operating right now that look at the static electricity potential in the air, and if this exceeds a certain level, we do not launch. And we would not waive that except if there was a very good reason.
A moment ago, you mentioned that you practice for every imagined contingency. What you're concerned about is the unimagined contingency that you haven't practiced for. And I was reminded of years ago in the first shuttle simulator at Houston, and I was in the simulator with John Young, and he was showing me how the thing would work, and we made a landing. And just as we made the landing, Mission Control came in and said, John, we have an indication of a fire in here. And John turned to me and said, not on the speaker back to Mission Control, but he said, what in the world do they want to practice that for now? They know we're just up here having a little fun. We haven't practiced a fire in the rollout. What a fire? I don't have any books here or anything. And they said, John, please, we have an indication of fire in here. He said, I know, I'm working on the problem. They said, oh, heck, not in the shuttle, in the building here. Get the devil out of there.
Oh, it's not funny, but it can cause confusion, can it? What's real and what's simulated?
Yeah.
Let's talk a moment about the crew. There are six other astronauts on board here. At times, we perhaps forget that. But the fact of the matter remains, it is a seven-member crew, including John Glenn, each of them outstanding in their own way. There's the walkout as you see them go by. This happened earlier this morning as they headed out to launch pad 39B. They're now all strapped in. The hatch is closed. And let's talk to Kurt Brown. I'll talk about Kurt Brown first. Kurt Brown is a graduate of the Air Force Academy. Spent a lot of time flying A-10 aircraft. He is a lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Air Force, 42 years old, from Elizabethtown, North Carolina. His mother has been very ho-hum about his career, but When she found out that he was going to be flying with Senator Glenn, she got rather excited. Now, sitting beside him in the right seat, Steve Lindsay. He's also an Air Force colonel. Steve Lindsay is the pilot, and he is 38. He is from Arcadia, California. He's the one who is pushing the concept of putting civilians in space, perhaps engaging in tourism in space someday, if that becomes practical. Mission specialist Stephen Robinson is the payload commander of this mission. His crewmates call him Steve Nye, the science guy. He is an interesting guy with a PhD who has a lot of interesting ideas about a lot of things. He's 43 years old, born in Sacramento, California, and he is excited to shake John Glenn's hand once they get into orbit, because John Glenn, the first time he went to orbit, was all alone. Scott Perezinski has a resume which would take up about six or seven of our screens here on CNN, so we'll give you the short version. Scott Perezinski has lived all over the world, is a medical doctor and mission specialist on this mission. He is 37 years old and originally from Little Rock, Kansas, although that doesn't really speak to his background. He's lived all over the world, as I say. He also is serving as the flight engineer, which means he sits in the middle seat right between the pilot and the commander. And as he has told us many times, for an astronaut, this is about as exciting as it gets. Pedro Duque, Juan Glenn, as they call him these days, around the Cape and in Houston. He will be the first Spaniard in space, if all goes well, in an hour and 25 minutes. He is 35 years old, born in Madrid, Spain. He's been waiting 6 years for a flight. He was with the European Space Agency, first signed on 6 years ago. Was training for some Mir missions, never got an opportunity, and this is his first opportunity. Jackie Mukai, also on board this mission. She is from Japan. She's a payload specialist, and she has already earned the title as the first Japanese woman in space on a previous mission. She's 46 years old, and she is also a medical doctor. And her mother, at age 73, said, "Oh, Shiaki, I want to go myself," when she heard that John Glenn was aboard. And finally, of course, the man who needs less biographical sketching for you, because you're pretty familiar with his story, John Glenn, the lowly payload specialist on this flight. A NASA astronaut who was among the first seven, the Mercury Seven, at the age of 77, making his second flight. Originally born in Cambridge, Ohio, grew up in New Concord, went on to a little career in politics, and now he's back in his original profession of flying high-performance aircraft and spacecraft. And Walter Cronkite, you've known John Glenn for years. I've heard you describe him as a Boy Scout, and I think you mean that as a compliment. Isn't that right?
Well, absolutely, although I'm not sure that all of his fellow astronauts actually considered it that way at the moment. I was quoting them. I wasn't making that up. It was their feeling about John was he was the oldest of the group, of the original seven, and he seemed a little humorless to them. He was so devoted to the mission. When they went to Langley, Virginia, for the first time, immediately after being selected as astronauts for training, for instance, all the rest of them took their families down there. They're going to live there for months, for years, perhaps. And he didn't take his family because he thought he ought to be devoting all of his time to the mission training. It was that kind of thing. And in almost each of the decisions all the way down the line, John was out there saying it ought to be done this way. Let's be sure we're right about it and do it this way. I think that's where he got the reputation of Boy Scout.
Well, you might get the impression, if you've, for instance, seen the movie The Right Stuff, that John Glenn was, the pejorative would be goody-two-shoes, and that the rest of the guys were just boys-will-be-boys kind of guys. I'm not sure that that's an entirely accurate picture.
I hate that picture.
Yeah.
I thought that Tom Wolfe's book, The Right Stuff, was pretty good. But when they made that into a movie, they turned it into a monkey house, fraternity house kind of an environment. They libeled almost everybody concerned, all the astronauts, all the backup personnel, all the scientists. They made the German scientists look like burlesque characters with their accent. Lyndon Johnson was made a buffoon. The press out to be a bunch of fools. It was a terrible situation.
All right. We're going to take a break. Our continuing coverage of the launch of the Discovery 7 will continue in just a moment. Stay with CNN.
cancer. If you're not satisfied with your current treatment program, call this very important phone number toll-free. At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we offer leading-edge medical technology, nutritional therapy, physical therapy, and emotional support. To find out about the innovative treatment options at our hospitals, call toll-free 1-800-807-9485. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, winning the fight against cancer every day.
Freude, schöne Güte, Funken, Tochter aus Elysium.
The all-aluminum Audi A8. Developed with Alcoa, it's the first premium luxury sedan with a 10-star safety rating. No wonder everyone's singing its praise.
It's soft. It's warm. And it's really comfortable. New carpet. It just feels better.
Prodigy Internet has fast email. So you spend less time online and more time on life. Prodigy Internet.
What if Lipper Analytical named you the number one small company fund of the last 10 years?
The Kaufman.
If Fortune Magazine ranked you as one of the best mutual funds for retirement 7 years in a row?
The Kaufman.
And if Smart Money Magazine named your portfolio managers as among the most influential in the mutual fund industry, you would be the Kaufman Fund, investing in small companies with substantial growth prospects. The Kaufman Fund. Call now for your free prospectus. 800-824-0600.
Live at the Kennedy Space Center, a shot from the Goodyear blimp looking down upon some of the hundreds of thousands expected people watching and waiting for the launch of the Space Shuttle Discovery coming up in an hour and 23 minutes or so, if all goes well. So far, things have gone well indeed. The orbiter performing as well as it can or should. No problems reported, and well, the weather. I suppose a picture speaks a thousand words. It is a beautiful blue sky. The wind is just barely fluttering those flags. We are T-minus 57 minutes and 27 seconds. That is going to bring us down to the, what is that? That is going to bring us down to the 20-minute hold, the T-minus 20-minute hold, which will last for 10 minutes. And once again, we've been explaining what holds are all about. That's just NASA's way of kind of keeping track of where they are on their schedule. They stop the countdown, they regroup, make sure everybody's doing their jobs correctly, and then start the clock once again. As we told you before the break, it's not just about John Glenn. There are six others aboard this mission, and there are 83 distinct experiments. They're going to have a very, very busy time once they're in orbit.
3, 2, 1, 0.
The flight of Gemini 4 in June 1965 marked not only America's first spacewalk, but also the first time manned space flight was controlled not from Cape Canaveral, but from Houston. Houston was picked over 18 other cities to be the home for mission control, whether it was a trip to the moon or Earth orbit in the shuttle.
Okay, stand by.
The fact that it's here is sort of irrelevant. Once the, like you say, once the vehicle launches, it could be anywhere on the face of the Earth.
And liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia on a mission.
While Florida maintains control over the launches, once the spacecraft lifts off the pad, Houston takes over.
Discovery Houston for EVA.
Go ahead, Houston.
Working in shifts around the clock, flight controllers monitor and analyze every aspect of the shuttle's performance and the crew's health.
We control the mission collectively, both in terms of helping the crew manage the system, maintaining the timeline, and doing the replanning and doing the bulk of the decision making here on the ground.
This newest version of mission control began operation just 3 years ago. It costs $250 million and uses standard workstations and local area networks, rather than the big mainframe-based system of the old mission control.
And there are some replanning summary sheets included in your execute package.
Astronauts fill the role of spacecraft communicators, CAPCOMs. They're the voice of mission control to the shuttle.
And also to represent the crew back to the flight control team and to sort of watch out for the crew's interests, help us keep an awareness of what the crew might be thinking in the cockpit or how the crew workload is being distributed among the crew members.
How important is mission control? Well, people here at the Johnson Space Center will remind you that when Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong first landed on the moon, the first word transmitted back to Earth was Houston. Tony Clark, CNN, Johnson Space Center.
Later.
All right. Clearly, that was not the piece which we had intended to give you. That was Tony Clark explaining why mission control for this, once the shuttle clears the tower, is in Houston. And I've got Walter Cronkite.
The real reason it was in Houston.
Well, tell us. Yeah.
Lyndon Johnson was the powerful majority leader of the United States Senate. They needed his support. They needed his money. And he represented the state of Texas. That's why it's in Houston. No, there was a little more reason than that. There was some thought, actually, they'd launch from that area. Then they decided that the Florida Peninsula was a better launching space, a little bit further south, which helps the azimuth of the orbit. So they gave up the launch from Houston. But that was one of the early considerations.
Dave Wolf, how do you feel about having kind of this bifurcated existence between Houston and Florida? Would astronauts prefer to be all in one place?
Well, it's important that our whole country share in the experience. We have space centers in almost every state, certainly business in every state of the Union. It certainly would simplify our lives a little bit, but it works out fine. I can tell you that they're critical and very important to the space flight. You saw Phil Engelhoff, the flight director. He's a critical player in this launch. As soon as the shuttle does its role just after launch, that center will be taking over control.
All right. And of course, Houston allows you an opportunity for a good excuse to get in those T-38 trainers and light it up and take a ride. So anyway, we're going to take a break. When we return, we will meet and discuss the mission with one of John Glenn's best friends. That's just, and we're going to have a surprise guest as well. So stay with CNN.
Look at that. The storm is over. The news crews have gone home. And the Florida Keys are back to normal. If you can call it that. Call 1-800-FLA-KEYS and come on down.
Candidate one, how would you address this issue? Candidate two, your rebuttal?
Sometimes, what candidates don't say is just as important as what they do say.
The Land Rover Discovery. Often imitated, never duplicated. And here's something else to think about. The Discovery has been ranked the most appealing compact sport utility vehicle in the J.D. Power and Associates Appeal Study. An appealing thought, if we do say so ourselves.
America, are you fed up with politicians' promises? Well, now you can do something about it. The Democrats gave us more taxes, more scandals, more government. Republicans took over, and what we get? More taxes, more scandals, more government. That's not what they promised. That's not what this country needs. So if you're tired of politicians more interested in keeping their jobs than in keeping their promises, make a change. This year, vote Libertarian, the party of principle.
Welcome back to our live coverage at the Kennedy Space Center, the launch of the Space Shuttle Discovery. Seven-member crew, payload specialist number two, one Senator John Glenn, Walter Cronkite at my side. We're having a good day so far. It's a perfect day for a space
launch. Great day for the beach.
Yes, it is. Speaking of the beach, we have a special guest sitting beside us, Jimmy
Buffett.
I thought
I'd give you a lead line.
Jimmy Buffett is here, a good friend of John Glenn's. You're actually here as a journalist. Tell us about that.
I'm a working journalist today, Miles. I'm covering this for Rolling Stone, and I have crewed for Captain Walter.
Yes, he is. He's a good crew member, too.
We won't talk about that one, will we?
All right.
Okay.
What are your impressions thus far?
Well, you know, it's the third launch I've been to, and from a Florida perspective, I'm trying to cover it from, like, the support teams. I was with the 45th support wing earlier yesterday, and then I went out with Johnny Tanner, who is Fish and Wildlife and gets pigs and alligators out of the trenches. So it's a pretty interesting perspective that we're really launching from a swamp.
And it's rich with wildlife, isn't it? A lot of people don't realize how rich Merritt Island is in wildlife, perhaps because it has been preserved.
It really is. It's amazing to me because of, you know, I'm pretty much involved in environmental causes in Florida, but you've got something as high-tech as NASA coexisting right here with an actual wildlife refuge. It's amazing. I don't think people realize that.
You know, when John and Ann Lindbergh came here for the first time, the space people wanted to show them everything about the space agency. What they wanted to see was the natural life out here in the swamp.
Well, I know. I was with Johnny yesterday. There's great snook fishing right out here, but I couldn't get my rod through security, Walter.
Well, security is tight. After all, the president is here on the compound. We'll be talking to him in just a little while exclusively. And Jimmy, how much opportunity have you had to talk with John Glenn recently?
I interviewed John Glenn in August in Washington as a part of this piece, and hopefully we'll go flying when he comes down. He goes to Florida at the end of this for a little R&R. And from a pilot-to-pilot perspective, you know, that's, as a pilot, you know, to fly that thing, I'd go in a minute. I know he would, too.
Oh, absolutely. We'd make a great team.
Who gets the captain, Walter?
Well, I hadn't thought we'd have to discuss that.
No, sir. Seniority, I'll be your co-pilot any day.
That would be a fun flight, I think. Yes, it would.
I think so, at a minute.
You bring your guitar, I hope.
Well, it is. It's interesting. When I was out at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Base, the interesting thing to me was the G-load that it carries. It's like 3.5 Gs for this, as opposed to the 62 launch, was about 9 Gs. And I've been in an F-14 on a carrier before, and 9 Gs is a lot. And I was asking that question as to why the difference. And now they can control the actual throttle on these engines. Before, it was light them and go.
Yeah. Now
This vehicle can't even stand 9 Gs.
Yeah.
3 Gs is just about its maximum.
It's amazing.
When it gets up there to what you'd be called max Q up there, they have to throttle back as they get to 3 Gs, throttle back and hold it at 3 Gs until they get through that period of vibration. Then they can come up to full throttle again.
It is, after all, a fragile and intricate vehicle. You got some butterflies thinking about all the crew
as they
sit in the pad.
It's an interesting thing, but it's from a pilot's perspective, you know what you're getting into when you jump in that thing, and you take the risk, and you know what's going to happen, and hopefully everything goes well.
All right, Jimmy Buffett, thank you very much.
Thank you, Miles.
From Margaritaville, we appreciate you being with us here at the Kennedy Space Center, and as we go to break, we'll take a look at the presidential motorcade making its way from Patrick Air Force Base all the way over to the Launch Control Center, which is right behind us. I guess the president doesn't travel light, does he? Stay with us.
Florida Keys, we're happy to report the winds have subsided, the seas are calm, and the rain is gone. Even so, we're always prepared to break out the umbrellas. The Florida Keys and Key West.
Experts say babies who get held a lot grow faster. That the touch of a hand can lower someone's blood pressure. That smiling releases helpful hormones. That Cigna Healthcare. These are all sound, scientific reasons for our particular way of doing things. It's called caring. And that should lower everyone's blood pressure. Cigna, a business of caring.
Tonight, can this man save must-see TV from sinking ratings? NBC's new secret weapon. CNN and Entertainment Weekly. Tonight, 10, 9 Central on CNN.
The automotive sale of the season from a dealership known for its spectacular savings events. It's Lou Webb's Irvine Toyota factory authorized clearance sale.
Factory to dealer incentives can save you thousands. And super low, low finance.
Plus, Camrys under $16,000. Forerunners under $20,000. Corollas under $12,000.
And a massive selection of Toyota certified pre-owned vehicles.
All at the Irvine Toyota factory authorized clearance sale. In the Irvine Auto Center.
I'm not a purple dinosaur. I'm not 64 bits. And I don't play pro ball. What I am is a mentor. Not a psychologist, but I'm a listener. I don't have all the answers. I'm a mentor. This is my reward.
Kids who have mentors are less likely to do drugs. Be a mentor.
If you're lucky, it's someone else's child who's going to school in a place like this. But in California, this is what many kids see every day. Our classes are more crowded than Mississippi's. 39 states spend more on schools than we do. That's why we've got to vote yes on Prop 1A. With strict accountability and without raising taxes, 1A will build new schools and repair old ones, provide access to computers, and reduce class size. Our children's future shouldn't be a matter of luck. Please vote yes on 1A.
Do you think it's fair to increase state taxes by $700 million when there's a huge budget surplus? Do you think we need 59 new government commissions requiring thousands of new bureaucrats? Should 500 new political appointees accountable to no one spend millions of your tax dollars without any independent audit? Should we create a special loophole making Prop 10 exempt from California's constitutional spending limits? If your answer is no, then vote no on Prop 10.
The Moneyline News Hour with Lou Dobbs, weeknight 6:30 Eastern on CNN.
Space Shuttle Discovery poised to make history. We are 1 hour away from a launch. The clock here at the Kennedy Space Center indicating all systems go, the weather, all systems go there. John Glenn's historic return to space is less than an hour away. The clock indicating T-minus 47 minutes with holds. That equates to about an hour.
February 20th, 1962.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
36 years later, former Mercury 7 astronaut, former senator, a true American hero, John Glenn returns to space.
I'm very proud to have been part of the beginnings of America's space program. And needless to say, I'm excited to be back.
Glenn made history when he became the first American to orbit the Earth. Today, a remarkable journey back to the heavens. At the age of 77, he will be the oldest human being to fly in space.
John Glenn is a card-carrying member of the AARP.
He's one of a seven-member team aboard the Space Shuttle Discovery in search of answers to the human aging process here on Earth.
There are some 35 million Americans over the age of 65. I view myself as representing those people.
The return of John Glenn to space and the return of Walter Cronkite to the anchor booth. This is CNN Live Coverage. Here now from Kennedy Space Center in Florida, CNN's Miles O'Brien and Walter Cronkite.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our continuing coverage of the launch of STS-95. That's the technical nomenclature for it, what everybody else is calling it, John Glenn's return to orbit, an historic occasion here at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida, and a perfect day for it. If NASA had to write a script for how to do a countdown, this is exactly how it would look. Let's take a look at some of the pictures we've been looking at all this morning as we introduce Walter Cronkite. Walter, can you remember one any smoother than this?
No, this one's going perfectly so far. And you almost hate to say that. You want to knock on wood, keep your fingers crossed, because there are a lot of things in that spacecraft that could go wrong between now and launch time to keep the launch from taking place. So we just have to hope that it keeps on like this. And we get off in about an hour.
All right, let's walk you through the day. The crew woke up on time, ate on time, and walked out to the launch pad on time. Let's take a look at some of the pictures as we've seen them. There is the seven-member crew. John Glenn right there in the second row to the right of your screen. They walked out at about 10:45 a.m. Eastern Time, exactly as NASA had scheduled it. They go into the motorhome and head their way onto Launch Pad 39B. They were strapped into the orbiter and the hatch was closed promptly at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. This is the middeck, and in the middle there is John Glenn being attended to by a suit technician. In the foreground, Chiaki Mukai, Japanese astronaut. Everybody getting buttoned up and ready for a tremendous liftoff, 8-minute and 30-second ride into orbit. John Glenn's second ride into orbit. The suit technicians doing their job, the launch pad ready, everyone else ready here and anticipating what is apt to be an historic occasion at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We've been talking a lot about John Glenn today. We've been talking about a lot of the crew. Let's take a look at John Glenn, a person who people know well, but who is somebody who is a complicated person who's done a lot of things besides fly in space and be a U.S. senator.
36 years ago, he took the ride of a lifetime. Today, he's having the time of his life.
It's exciting, and I'm just glad to be back and be part of it.
For John Herschel Glenn, Jr., the joyride began July 18, 1921, in Cambridge, Ohio. As long as anyone can remember, he was fascinated by airplanes. He was 8 when he took his first flight.
It was quite an experience because, you know, there you are up there suddenly looking down on houses and roads and all the other things that people experience have experienced in going up in airplanes. And that really impressed me as a boy. And I wondered at that time, I guess, whether I could ever fly myself or not.
He had found one of the two enduring loves of his life. He met the other at about the same time, Anna Margaret Castor. Annie, the daughter of a new Concord dentist.
It's rumored that they started looking at each other at the age of 3, and it lasted and still exists throughout their whole lifetime.
They were married less than a week after Glenn earned his wings as a Marine fighter pilot. The year was 1943. Glenn shipped out almost immediately for some dangerous duty. He flew 59 combat missions in World War II, 63 in Korea. His dogfighting days behind him, Glenn ascended to the rarefied air of flight testing.
These are the astronauts.
In April of 1959, he and 6 other square-jawed jet jockeys were introduced to the country as the Mercury 7. He was a Boy Scout among pranksters. But when it came time to pick the first and the second to fly, the Boy Scout did not get the merit badge. Instead, John Glenn drew flight number 3, the first U.S. orbital mission.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
The nation held its breath as his autopilot failed, and he flew the tiny capsule by hand, then made a fiery dive back into the atmosphere with a warning light showing his heat shield might have been loose. In less than 5 hours, he splashed down, safe and sound, a superstar of Lindbergh proportions.
Wherever I went, or I went with my family, it was just like a tidal wave of emotion almost sort of sweeping over us at that time. It was something we hadn't foreseen at that time, but it was something we lived through, and I think we handled it all right. I guess we did.
But fame turned out to be a two-edged sword for John Glenn. Fearing the loss of a national hero, John Kennedy grounded Glenn without telling him so directly. When Glenn saw the writing on the wall, he left NASA frustrated, disappointed, but still on a mission to succeed. And so he did as an entrepreneur and executive for Royal Crown Cola. But the business world was too confining for this global icon, so he threw his helmet into the political ring, finally winning a seat in the Senate in 1974. In 1984, he aimed for the highest heights in politics, but the Glenn for President campaign never really got off the pad. He was a moderate among political zealots, an optimist among cynics.
I think John Glenn always wanted to see the best in people and always expected the best from people, and he didn't realize that sometimes you had to contend with what the worst is that the human race has to offer.
Do you solemnly swear that the testimony that you would give before this hearing will be the truth? Nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
Perhaps it was that trusting nature which laid the groundwork for his darkest political days. He was one of the so-called Keating Five, senators accused of unethical ties to Charles Keating, who was implicated in the junk bond scandal of the late 1980s.
That was probably the low point of my life, was to have those kind of charges that eventually, as I knew they would be, were proven to be untrue.
If that was the valley, this must have been the peak.
I am extremely proud to announce that John Glenn of Ohio, the first American to orbit the Earth, will get his long-awaited and much-deserved second flight.
This January, NASA Administrator Daniel Goldin finally gave John Glenn that long-delayed second flight, the one Glenn had been lobbying for years.
This is not a flight of fancy. This is a flight for the future.
Some people thought I was going just because I was a senator and I demanded to go or something, which absolutely was not true. I wouldn't go that way. This wasn't a payoff or anything like that.
It may not be a payoff, but payload specialist John Glenn wanted to be here very badly. And when John Glenn is determined, it seems there's little on or off Earth that can stop him.
And his determination has led us to this point. T-minus 34 minutes and 19 seconds, which when you account for about 20 minutes of expected built-in hold time that NASA likes to do, means that the launch is scheduled in about 55 minutes, and so far there's nothing stopping it. Walter.
You know, we met a lot of people here this morning, past astronauts, present astronauts, some of the pioneers of the space program and the launch teams. I'd like to introduce now another hero of the early days, a pioneer of space around here. The fellow's name is Henry Landworth, and he was spent his youth, unfortunately, in one of the concentration camps of Hitler's, Auschwitz. Came to this country as a survivor after that terrible experience, found his way to Cocoa Beach, where he was the first manager of one of the first motels at Cocoa Beach, just as the space age was brimming. And he became a close friend of all of the astronauts, the pioneer astronauts, the Mercury 7, who stayed at his hotel, and all of us news people who stayed at his hotel. He was a hero to all of us. And Henry, it's delightful to have you here today. I know you're now a very successful hotelier and in Orlando and elsewhere. John Glenn is a fellow investor with you in your hotels, and he's a very dear friend of yours. We heard a moment ago from Jimmy Buffett, who was also one of our guests here just a moment ago, about trying to go fishing out here. And I was reminded that Gordon Cooper once took advantage of your hospitality to go fishing.
Yes, he did. I came one morning to the hotel, and Gordon was sitting on the side of the pool with a fishing pole. And I walked over to Gordon. I said, Gordon, what in the world are you doing? I said, I came here to fish. I got some time, so I'm going fish. And I looked down to the pool, and there's four fish. I said, stop it. This is a pool, Gordon. I said, I'm not going, stop. I'm going fish. And he went on fishing. Nothing could stop him.
Where did he get the fish?
I have no idea. There were four of them in that pool.
Well, he must have supplied his own fish, I gather. That was your conclusion, wasn't it? So there were a lot of practical jokes played on you, and you played it on them.
Yes.
It was a game of practical jokes. Tell me about the towel episode with John Glenn.
One day I heard John Glenn came to the lobby, pounded on a desk, and said, what is going on with this hotel? I don't get any towels in my room. And I walked out. I said, John, quiet down. I mean, people are hearing you. Please stop. He says, no, no, you're going to give me the towels. I'm going to demand. And he just made a racket out of this thing. So he went on his mission. He came back. And I put about 2.5-ton truck of towels in his room. He couldn't get into the room. He couldn't open the door. And then he called me up and says, get me out of the room, Henry. I'm sorry about the towels. So that was the story.
Henry, we've talked much about the delays of MA-6, John Glenn's flight. He made it finally on the 11th attempt. It was set up 10 times before he actually got off. 3 times he was suited up, twice at the top of the pad.
Right.
But you had your problems with those delays of that flight, didn't you?
Big one. Big one. I felt that I really wanted to do something for John Glenn. And he has been my best friend now for 38 years. And I was determined to do something that nobody else will do. So I decided I will build them a cake, bake them a cake of the exact measurements of the capsule, which was 6 feet wide and 9 feet tall. And everything was set till the next day, my chef comes into my office and says, we went along with this, your request, and we all for it. There's only one problem. When we build that cake 6 feet wide, it wouldn't get to the door of our kitchen. So I said, well, there must be a way. So what we went ahead and hired a big truck, I don't know, the biggest truck we could get, and we were assembling that cake in that truck. It was a pound cake and a fruit cake. And that cake was ready to be rolled out. McDonnell Aircraft was giving us, actually built us a lift, special lift for the cake. And when John went up to space, that cake was supposed to be rolled out when he was coming down to Earth. So I called Charlie Buckley, who was at that time the chief of security. I said, Charlie, I want to get that cake out to the Cape, and we're going to cut this with all the dignitaries and everything. And I just told him, listen, Charlie, this is important. He says, no, it's not important at all. I'm tired of this cake. You're never going to go and come to the Cape, and there's no way you're going to poison 2,000-3,000 people with that stupid cake. Well, anyway, I said, Charlie, I'm going to make a deal with you. You send me two dietitians from the astronauts, and one of them was Finkelstein. I'm sure you knew him. And he did that. Now, if that cake is good, would you allow me to come out? And that cake was good. And we rolled it out to the cake. And Mr. McDonnell, Gil Root, all the boys were cutting that cake, and it was a big celebration. It was fun.
Well, Henry, thank you very much. You were a hero to us news people, I can tell you, because in those early days, when before NASA took over the space program, and it was a U.S. Air Force effort, the Air Force felt very heavily about security, naturally, because they were thinking of weaponry rather than man in space, and they wouldn't let us onto the Cape at all. So we had to stand on a granite fairway out there by Port Canaveral. Cold, miserable, all night long. We wouldn't know until the lights went on that they were about to launch one of their experimental rockets. But we'd have to be out there, our poor cameramen there, keeping their eyes glued on that lighted, and we didn't know when it had been scrubbed, because the light stayed on. It might have been scrubbed for hours, and we'd still be out there all night long waiting. But we complained about this quite a lot around the bars. Henry overheard us, and he found the answer. He knew how to tell us whether the mission had been scrubbed or not. When the engineers all came in from the Cape and went to the bar, he knew that the mission had been scrubbed. He sent a messenger out to us, and we were able to join them at the bar. Henry, thanks a lot. Good luck to you.
Thank you, sir. Great thank time. You. Right. Thanks well, for right. inviting me. Right.
That's
thank
what
you.
I, that's
thank
what I you, call sir. A reliable thank source. You. Stay seated for a second. We're going to take a break. When we return, the President of the United States is here. He's at the Launch Control Center. We're going to have an exclusive interview with him shortly. Stay with CNN.
No one knows more about the safety of pain relievers than doctors and hospitals. And the pain reliever they choose most? Tylenol. In fact, for pain relief, doctors recommend Tylenol more than all other brands combined. For over 20 years, Tylenol has been the first choice of doctors and hospitals. It's simply the most trusted combination of strength and safety in pain relief today. Tylenol, the pain reliever hospitals use most.
Hi there. Can we get you anything?
Oh, no, I'm fine.
Are you enjoying your stay, sir? you're on vacation, huh?
No business. But the Best Western for a seminar.
Isn't that still going on?
Workshops today. I slipped out the back. Boss is never going to know I spent all day on the beach. You're not going to tell him, are you?
Can we get you some lotion?
Lotion? I'm tougher than that.
Baseball players know a lot about home equity loans.
So do football players.
At Superior Bank, we don't play games with your financial future. Instead, Superior has been helping homeowners for over 75 years, helping homeowners reduce their bills to one monthly payment and get the cash they need when they need it. even if they've had credit problems in the past. So if you're tired of playing games, call Superior Direct now at 1-888-678-7777.
For the 14 million women who worry about light to moderate bladder control, now there's new double protection Compose panty and pad system. The Compose panty and pad fit together for double protection. There's a super absorbent disposable pad, but the real difference is the separate washable panty. It gives you double protection with a quilted panel that won't let wetness through. So why worry? Get double protection with Double Protection Compose. Protection that goes beyond the pad.
Hi, sis. I know it's my turn to go and help Mom, but...
Oh, I have a meeting. I'll try Carol.
Okay, I'll be there as soon as I can.
If you find it hard to give a loved one all the help they need, there's only one phone call to make. Kelly Assisted Living can provide additional and ongoing assistance with dressing, bathing, cooking, and errands.
Hi, Mom. You look great.
Thanks, Marie.
For more information, call Kelly Assisted Living at 1-800-YES-KELLY.
When you buy a home, what are you really buying? Maybe it's three bedrooms, a fireplace, a nice little yard. But you're also buying the promise of better schools, safer streets, a place your kids can come home to, and a special feeling of community. All of which makes owning a home a pretty good deal for all of us. For a free guide that can help you on the path to home ownership, call the Fannie Mae Foundation.
Special guest with us, Miles, at this moment. Well, not exactly with us, around us. President of the United States, Bill Clinton, is over at the Vehicle Assembly Building, right over here, a couple hundred yards away from us. And we have the privilege of saying good morning to him, welcoming him on behalf of CNN, at any rate, to Cape Canaveral and this launch. Good to see you, Mr. President.
Good morning, Walter, and good morning, Miles, or good afternoon. I'm delighted to be here.
They say, Mr. President, that there are more visitors here than any time since the moon launchings, the moon flights, and that includes the President of the United States. What's particularly appealing to you about this flight?
Well, of course, there's the John Glenn factor. Senator Glenn is a very good personal friend of Hillary's and mine, as well as an ally, a colleague, and like all Americans, I'm thrilled that he's going up today. But also, you know, this really is the last launch before we begin to put the International Space Station up. So John Glenn began this first phase of our space program, and he's ending it just before we start on the space station. So it's very exciting. It's important for the space program, but it's a great day for America, a great day for our senior citizens, I hope that all Americans share the exuberance that I feel today.
You know, some naysayers say, Mr. President, that this flight of Glenn's is your reward to him for his stalwart support of yours during his years in the Senate. Anything to that?
No. I've always wanted John to be able to go back, as long as I've known he's wanted to. But if I'd had my druthers, he'd be home in Ohio running for re-election right now. He said he was too old to serve another term in the Senate, but he wasn't too old to go into space. And
right.
I think the American people should know that the decision to send him was made strictly by the book. I had no role in it. He had to pass the strenuous physical exams. And then for each experiment he's going through, he had to prove that he was qualified and able to do that. I think this is very important. You know, one of the most important benefits that the American people derive from our space program is the whole rush of discoveries we get that help us here on Earth. Environmental discoveries, healthcare discoveries of all kinds. We've got all kinds of medical scanning equipment today that we wouldn't have but for the space program. We've got protective clothing that people who are super sensitive to the sun can wear that we wouldn't have but for the space program. So we're gonna get a lot out of John Glenn going up there today, and I think the country is well served by doing it, and goodness knows, for a lifetime of service to us in the air and on the ground, he's earned this chance.
You know, they say that President Kennedy grounded Glenn after his first flight because he didn't want to risk the death of a hero out there in a second flight. Would you have made that decision?
Well, I don't know. I can't say because I wasn't there then, and it's easy to second guess. But I'll say this. I think that John Glenn going up today is a very good thing for America. We're going to learn a lot from it, and we're all going to, I think, be thrilled by it. And I'm just glad he was brave enough to do it.
You know, out there on pad 39A, Mr. President, there to the right, to the south of the 39B from which this flight will take place, there's a shuttle scheduled to take into orbit in just a few months the first parts of the planned American-Russian Joint International Space Station, almost a small city permanently in space. Well, now the Russia has this desperate economic situation that endangers that schedule. It looks like we may have to put in a lot of money, to try to keep that space station on schedule,
yes.
The construction of it. Are we prepared to do that?
Well, Walter, if it were required, I would be supportive of it, and I would be happy to talk to the congressional leaders in both parties. You know, our space program has been a great investment. It's had hardly any increase in funding since I became president. But we've gone from 2 launches to 8 launches a year. We've dramatically cut costs. NASA is the sort of the star, the poster child of Vice President Gore's Reinventing Government campaign, and we're getting a lot out of it. If we were required now to help the Russians during this difficult period, which will not last forever, so that they could continue to participate, I would be in favor of that. I think that it's very important that we have the Europeans, the Japanese, the Canadians, and the Russians in the space station venture. I've been here, I've been over the space station project many times in great detail in Houston. I've been twice, I've been down there to look at that. And I think we're doing the right thing with this space station, and we need to stay with it.
Mr. President, it's Miles O'Brien. I have a question for you, but first I want to check the countdown clock for our viewers for just a moment. We have now entered into a hold, a 10-minute hold. We are at T-minus 20 minutes and holding. The hold began at 1:20 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It will end at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Time. And then we'll count down again to 9 minutes, another 10-minute hold at that point. Once again, to remind our viewers, this is simply a way of NASA keeping up with the important business at hand and making sure everybody's doing their job in time. Mr. President, I'm just curious, are you nervous?
Oh, a little bit. I think that it's part of the excitement. I'm a little nervous, but I've got great confidence in these people. I've had a lot of great honors as president to meet people who serve our country, but meeting the people who are in the space program, the astronauts, those who work on the ground, those who plan these missions, they've done everything they can possibly do, and they would never compromise an iota of safety or reliability just because Hillary and I and all the rest of the world are here through the media. I feel good about this, but yes, I'm nervous and I'm excited. I feel like a kid at his first Christmas. I'm very excited about this.
Mr. President, President Bush, 1989, proclaimed the national goal to send humans to the planet Mars by the year 2019. That's the 50th anniversary of Neil Armstrong's first step onto the moon. Do you affirm that goal for the Mars mission?
Well, let me say, what we're doing now will help us once we get to the position of evaluating that. I don't want to either affirm or renounce it. What I think we should do is to recognize that what we have now is a set of very focused goals in our space program. We are working on the space station. We are working on the shuttle. We are working on space transportation. We are working on things that tell us about our environment on Earth. And then we're doing these special projects, the Hubble telescope, which is magnificent. And we did the Mars Pathfinder mission on, you remember, July the 4th of last year. And so we're going to see how we are. Let's get the space station up and going and evaluate what our long-term prospects are. I tell you this, I am for the continued aggressive exploration of space in ways that are high quality, cost-effective, and that will benefit us here on Earth. And I hope that we can have, as a result of this flight today, even more broad-based American support from all Americans of all parties and all walks of life for our mission in space. It's still very, very important.
Mr. President, as a journalist, I think I'd be remiss at this moment in time if I didn't ask you what your advisors are telling you about the results of next Tuesday's election.
The truth is, they don't know. We've got an extraordinary number of very, very close elections. In this 2-year period, the members of the other party raised, $100 million more than our folks did. But we've got good candidates and an extremely good grassroots effort. I think a good agenda. The only thing I think I should say today, to avoid being too political, is that it's a very important election. And I would hope that every American who is eligible to vote would go and vote in that election. If you look at this space launch today, this is a triumph of American democracy. It was made possible by the elected representatives of the American people supporting the space program. And it is just one more example of why it's so important for citizens to stand up and be counted on Election Day. So if you feel patriotic when you see John Glenn and the others go up in space today, then keep that patriotic feeling till next Tuesday and go and vote for the candidate and the programs and the issues of your choice.
All right. Mr. President, thank you so much for being with us on CNN today. And we hope you enjoy the launch.
Thank you. I will. I think I ought to say just one other thing because I'm talking to CNN. I know that I speak for a lot of people when I express my thanks to the late John Holloman for the work he did to advance our cause in space. And I know that all of you will be thinking about him and his family today. And I thank CNN for giving such a high profile to our space mission. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. President, for those words. Miles and I were going to dedicate this broadcast at an appropriate time to the memory of John Holloman, who was the space expert at CNN, was as skilled as Miles, planned to be in this anchor chair, and who was killed, unfortunately, in an automobile accident just a couple of weeks ago. This podcast is dedicated to the memory of John Holloman.
All right, it's time for us to take a break. When we return, we'll check in and see how the crowds are doing along the beaches. CNN's Mark Potter there, Goodyear blimp hovering overhead. With the clock holding at 20 minutes, stay with us.
Tonight, can this man save must-see TV from sinking ratings? NBC's new secret weapon. CNN and Entertainment Weekly. Tonight, 10, 9 Central on CNN.
It takes a revolution to make a solution.
I was looking for a solution in the air and noise pollution. Yesterday she came around and said, let's start a revolution. I said, I don't wanna go. I wanna hang around at home.
Bill Jones is running for Secretary of State, but he's also running from his extreme record. The problem? He's got to carry big tobacco because they give him lots of money. Jones and his running mate Dan Lundgren are both against a woman's right to choose. He's got to carry the oil companies because he supports offshore drilling. Jones even opposes a ban on assault weapons. Bill Jones, right-wing extremist. He can run, but he can't hide.
Go Inside Politics, now for a full hour, weekdays 5 Eastern on CNN.
Welcome back live, the Kennedy Space Center, the place, perhaps a place where history will be made in just a short while, a little more than a half hour. That clock reads 20 minutes and holding, T-minus 20 minutes and holding to be specific. We are in the middle of a 10-minute planned hold that is part of NASA's routine here as they tidy up business, make sure everybody is set to go on to the next level, which will begin at 1:30 p.m. Eastern time. They will count the clock down to 9 minutes and engage in another 10-minute hold. Once again, all this is about safety. All this is about making sure everybody's doing their job right. All this is about making sure we have a safe flight today. Nothing on the horizon whatsoever, which would indicate the shuttle will not launch on time at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The crowds are big all along Florida's Space Coast, all along the beaches and the causeways. Several hundred thousand people reported in attendance, camping out, barbecuing, enjoying what they hope will be a historic occasion, John Glenn's second ride into space. CNN's Mark Potter is among them. Mark?
Well, Miles, the crowds are definitely growing, and people are standing by, in fact, standing up. It appears that
I'll do the blimp after.
They're all very excited to see the shuttle, and they know it's coming. It's about a half hour away, and so everyone knows that, and they're getting ready for it. Now, we have been told by tourism officials that the estimates of about 300,000 people coming here have been met. They think that it's truly been that many people that have made it this way now. And the bridges, the roads, the beaches from Patrick Air Force Base north to the shuttle area and then beyond are jammed with people now. In fact, the Sheriff's Department tells us that the Max Brewer Causeway that connects Titusville and the Kennedy Space Center has been closed down because it's just jammed with traffic. There are so many cars there, they can't go anywhere, and that's where the people are going to watch the liftoff. Whether they wanted to or not, they're stuck. And it's actually not a bad viewing spot. It's pretty close. Some of the traffic has been backed up for 5 miles, we've been told. But overall, the Sheriff's Department says that everything has been going well. There have been no major problems, no major injuries, and everything is going well. And everyone is now just waiting for the launch. Miles, back to you.
Can't do you yet. All right. All right, thank you very much, Mark Potter. Enjoying the scene from the group on the causeway and the beaches. The clock has started up once again, and we will continue counting down from 19 minutes and 24 seconds on down to 9 minutes, and then we'll have another 10-minute hold. Once again, all part of the routine here. Let's move along to Ohio. You know, Ohio, for some reason, is the home to more astronauts than any other state. The Buckeye State has 23 astronauts, present and former. Jeff Flock is in New Concord, where John Glenn was born and has spent most of his life. Jeff?
That's right, Miles. We still haven't figured out exactly why there are more astronauts here from Ohio, but we know it's true. We're at Muskingum College. It's a small college out here in New Concord, Ohio. And if you go down to the floor, we're up here with a couple of special guests who have spent some special times with John Glenn over the years. But first, I want to take you down to the floor and show you the big screen televisions that have been set up. It's reminiscent of 36 years ago. It was the college gymnasium back then, too, where all the press and all of the townsfolk gathered to watch their hero reach for the stars. And they are here again. The old gymnasium where that took place is actually now named for John Glenn. And I'm with one man who was the best man at his wedding and another man who played football with him here at Muskingum. And Lloyd White, I guess I have to ask you, what's going through your mind and what's different about this one than the one 36 years ago?
Well, I think, as John said, the technology is so much improved now. I guess I'm not as nervous as I was 36 years ago.
He's got a pretty good chance of coming back this time.
Oh, I think so, yeah. I think so. I'm not too worried about that part of it.
Yeah. We've got a picture, by the way, of that wedding day. You said you almost don't remember that. That was quite a while ago.
Yeah, well, yeah. And I didn't know there was any pictures ever taken of it. But I do have a clipping that told who was there, so yeah, that was a great day. He was in service at that time, yeah, and came back from service and in his uniform, and I was his best man. There was another student, another guy who had been in school there. But I don't know who it was.
I want to move to Harold Kaser now, who played football here at Muskingum with him. Harold, did you ever have any indication when you were playing football together back then where John would wind up?
No indication where he'd wind up, but we knew he had some real basic skills. He was a good player. He played center on the team, and he hit hard. He had certain goals that he wanted to accomplish. He was committed to accomplish his goals. He was a good guy, good sportsman.
You know, we've got a camera outside. It's out at the old gym, which is back then not named for him, but it is now, and plant a time capsule out there to kind of mark this momentous occasion. Now, Lloyd, about John going up now at his age, some people have criticized it and said, oh, it's just a reward for past service and all that sort of thing.
Well, he's serious about this. Of course, he's been chairman of the aging committee for the Senate, you know.
Makes sense to you.
Yeah, and he's worked a long time on this.
Lloyd, Harold, I appreciate it very much. Thank you so much. We're going to leave you with a shot of this place. I guess it explains, Miles and Walter, as well as anything can, why John Glenn is who he is. It's out in this small town, out in this country, this beautiful country of Ohio. It's where he came from, and he'll never be farther away from New Concord than he will be today, but in some ways, I guess he takes a little bit of it with him. That's the latest from here, folks. Back to you.
All right, Jeff Flocke in a beautiful New Concord, Ohio. Look at those fall colors there. A beautiful day there, just as it is a beautiful day here. We have a couple of special guests joining Walter and me. First of all, sitting immediately to my right, Buzz Aldrin, the second man to walk on the moon, who has been sitting here watching the countdown go down, and from Sacramento.
I think I recognize him anyway.
And
can't miss seeing you, Walter.
And from Sacramento, California, Chuck Yeager, the man who first broke the sound barrier in an aircraft. Chuck, first of all, what are you thinking about this flight? Good idea?
Yeah, pretty good, Neil. You know, NASA sorely needs some publicity, and they couldn't have picked a better guy than John Glenn, who did such a tremendous job back in 1962. And I'm watching with a great deal of anticipation. And talking to Walter Cronkite, man, I get the feeling this is an old man's show, with the exception of the young six that are hauling John up into space, and talking to Walter, who's been around for a long time, and myself. Last time I saw Walter, we were on the ramp at Edwards looking at a bunch of old airplanes, if you remember, Walter.
Never forget that, Chuck. And as a matter of fact, I wonder, are you a little more comfortable today with this form of rocketry? You and I, after my talking to you, I became convinced that we should have been working on returnable aircraft from the very beginning, rather than go for the disposable booster.
Yeah, basically, like you got Buzz there beside you, he sort of served as a commandant of the Aerospace Research Pilot School. The Air Force was very much in space with the MOLD, Manned Orbital Laboratory, and the X-20 Dinosaur, which was a reusable space vehicle, but they sort of changed things in 1966 and made space for peaceful purposes, and we sort of backed out of the space program, and consequently, NASA has done a very good job, with the exception. I just sort of get the feeling that it would have been better to put a young astronaut in that seat that John is sitting in so that we could use him for the next 15 years.
Yeah, well, when you took X-1 up there and broke the sound barrier, we thought maybe you'd go right on up to the stars.
Well, that I wasn't qualified to be a NASA astronaut since I only had a high school education, but it was fun flying airplanes.
You bet. Well, you did a great job of it, too, Chuck.
Thank you very much, Walter.
You bet.
Chuck, let me ask you one question. I know in the early days of the program, test pilots such as yourself often had disparaging remarks for astronauts. They felt the old spam in the can analogy applied. I assume you think differently these days. Is that true?
No. Basically, the shuttle is an airplane, and the guys who fly it like an airplane and land it like an airplane. Originally, with the stuff that Buzz flew and the original seven astronauts, they had very little control over where the vehicle landed because it had a very low LORD. And consequently, I was an airplane guy and didn't hold an awful lot of interest in the capsule return. The shuttle's a different vehicle because it flies like an airplane.
Well, Buzz, go ahead.
I'm afraid if we had stuck with airplanes, the Russians might have beat us to the moon. I think we needed capsules. We needed the simplest way to get up and then provide the maneuverability on orbit and as much control of the landing site as possible. It certainly is a viable way to put things into orbit with airplanes, as we're seeing with the shuttle. I'm very much in favor of booster rockets, first stage rockets, coming back and landing like an airplane, but being launched vertically.
Yeah,
well, I wonder. Go ahead, Chuck.
Yeah, basically, Buzz, if you recall, the X-20 was a very similar vehicle to the shuttle itself, but we'll never know, so it's all speculation.
Well, I suppose in a perfect world, you could have had both programs going simultaneously, but money was scarce, as it always is.
Perfect and even richer world.
Exactly.
Well, when an airplane has to carry all the fuel along with it, it gets to be quite large. When it's just being boosted, as the shuttle is just being boosted, and the X-20 was just going to be boosted, you have to do something to contain all that rocket fuel that's going to get it going up there, and you'd like to recover that part, and that means a recoverable booster.
Yeah.
Chuck, I want to ask you said at the outset that you feel that NASA needs the publicity, and this is a good publicity, well, stunt, perhaps. NASA continues to insist this is about science. Do you believe them?
Yeah, well, I don't believe it's as important as you would be led to believe, basically because one seven-day orbit by one old guy, like we all are old, in my opinion, won't give you very valid data, and that's the way I feel about it.
Would you like to go if you had the opportunity?
No, it'd be a waste of money. I'd rather see the young guys, of which there's more than 100 sitting there in Houston, eager to get into space, and we could use them for the next 15 years as active astronauts. And that's just the way I feel about it.
Well, you know, Chuck, they say that one man, a database doesn't make. In the case of John Glenn, one man's experience at the age of 77 up there won't do it. You're a young kid of 75 right now. Why don't we have a succession of flights, and all of us at this advanced age will go one by one, and we'll get a good database for it.
Walter, if I remember a few years ago, you were sort of slated to go up in the shuttle, and I agree. You know, quantity makes a good quality.
I think we're building a crew here today. Cronkite, Buffett, Yeager, and Aldrin. Yeah.
No, I agree with Walter. I think one of the most necessary things we need right now is a journalist in space.
Yeah.
I'd like to see people explain to the public why individuals would want to go into space in a very professional way, a way that the public can relate to and can understand, and not a biased point of view of someone whose profession it is to be in space. But we want to know why a journalist would take the risk. After all, you get paid a lot just by staying on the ground. It's not the pay, I'm sure of that. But even more important than that, I think, is to relate the desire to be in space. Why do you take the risk? Because we're laying the groundwork for the next generation space shuttle, which is going to carry a good number of people into space. Not just the number that NASA needs, but the number that are needed economically for a tourism industry.
Yep.
All right, gentlemen,
well,
I have to jump in for 1 minute. I got to tell you, excuse me, Chuck, I got to jump in here for 1 minute. The words "Godspeed, John Glenn" were etched in all of our memories. Anybody who's ever seen that launch, the words uttered by Scott Carpenter. As we look at the clock as it counts down toward the launch of Discovery, Scott Carpenter is here at the Kennedy Space Center, and he will be uttering similar greetings to the orbiter. However, they won't be able to hear it. They'll hear it later. It'll be sent up via satellite to the orbiter after it attains its orbit this afternoon. And let's listen in to that.
For the crew aboard Discovery.
Yes, at this point in the count, it seems appropriate to say to the shuttle Discovery crew, good luck, have a safe flight, and to say once again, Godspeed, John Glenn.
Carpenter served as Glenn's backup for
the
Mercury.
Those words etched in all our memories. Godspeed, John Glenn. It said it all then, and Scott Carpenter embellishing upon it today. It kind of gives you goosebumps at that moment, doesn't it?
What are you up to these days, Buzz? I see you more than almost any of the other astronauts. We meet in the strangest places. Rhodes, one place.
Island, yes.
Yes, right. Yeah.
Well, I was in the process of writing a book over there when we met maybe 10 years ago, something like that.
Yeah.
I've written another science fiction story since then. That's being made into a television movie. I'm working on another space thriller, but in addition to that, the more pertinent things. I'm working with an organization with reusable first stage rockets. We take a rocket that already exists, like an Atlas, and we put an airplane around it so that after it does its job of lifting the upper stages, it comes back and flies like an airplane back to land.
How did
I introduce this
idea?
One of the
Peenemunde boys, one of the German Peenemunde scientists, Kraft Ericke,
yes,
who worked for Convair, built the Atlas. He had this plan of getting the Atlas actually launched and then taking those empty tanks and mm-hmm. building a space station of those. It made a lot of sense.
Well, that's going to make sense in the future as I see it too, Walter.
All right, for now, it's Grist for Science Fiction. We do have to take a break right now. We want to thank General Yeager, who is still with us on the line from Sacramento. Godspeed, Chuck Yeager. We appreciate you being with us here on CNN today.
Thanks, and good luck.
All right, take care.
Take care, Chuck.
All right, we're going
to
take a break.
Good to talk to you, Chuck.
The countdown here continues. CNN's live coverage continues. We are now about 17 minutes away from the expected liftoff of the Space Shuttle Discovery. The clock holding at 9 minutes. Stay with us.
What if a visitor from the next world...
Do I blend in?
What does he want?
I wish to see the world.
Fell in love with someone from ours.
Tell me about yourself, Joe.
I'm sometimes not quite at home around the people.
What if he had to make a choice between this world...
I have this weak feeling in my knees.
...and the next...
Did you tell her who you are?
Brad Pitt, Anthony Hopkins, meet Joe Black.
I don't want to leave.
Then don't.
Rated PG-13. Starts November 13th.
Candidate 1. How would you address this issue? Candidate 2. Your rebuttal?
Sometimes, what candidates don't say is just as important as what they do say.
Here's something you should never do with your eyeglasses unless they're made from Flexon. Even after bending and twisting, Flexon frames still look and fit great. Feel free to fall asleep in your glasses. Feel free to squeeze your Flexon frames. Feel free to kid around. Flexon frames, durable, comfortable, light. Ask for them by name. Flexon by Marshawn.
Back to our continuing and extensive coverage of the launch of STS-95, the launch of Discovery, the return of John Glenn to space. You're looking at live pictures taken from the Goodyear blimp at some of the causeway's docks and beaches where hundreds of thousands of people are expected to witness this launch, now about 14 and a half minutes away. This has been a controversial mission all along. A lot of people have said it's a part PR stunt, maybe it's a political payoff, that it has really little to do with science. Among those critics, a former NASA historian, Alex Rowland, who now is in academia. He joins us from Duke University in Raleigh, North Carolina. Alex, is it a stunt?
Well, it's not quite a stunt. That is, I think it's a trip that Senator Glenn has wanted for years, and he finally prevailed upon NASA to let him fly. And I think most of us, even the critics of the flight, think that it's a reasonable thing to do. Glenn has had a very distinguished career. He never got his chance for his second flight, and I think we'd all applaud it if he would just go up, and we'd all recognize it as a nostalgia trip, which we're all having, I think. Yet the problem arises when you represent it as science, because it's clearly not science.
What about the risks involved, Alex? Do you think it's too risky putting someone of this age on a space shuttle where a situation might occur where they'd have to rapidly exit?
Well, I think there is a slightly elevated risk if you have someone, first of all, who hasn't trained as much as the other astronauts and also, you know, just isn't as young and isn't in their physical condition, though Senator Glenn is a remarkable physical specimen for somebody 77 years old. So I think there's a slightly elevated risk, but I don't think it's terribly significant.
Dr. Rowland, you're critical to a degree of the raison d'etre, at any rate, for this flight.
Right.
But you're also in the history department at Duke University. And looking at space so far and its position in our economic priorities, these flights cost around $500 million apiece, an average around $450 to $500 million. That would build an awfully lot of schools. I meant to ask this to the president, we ran out of time. But is it in your mind, a history professor, is it worth it?
I don't think so. Clearly, after we've developed this capability to send people into space, we want to sustain it and maintain it. I'm not sure we have to do as many flights as we do. And in fact, that number of 450 or 500 million is NASA's number. I think a much more realistic estimate is a billion. Some people have even estimate a billion and a half for each flight if you include development costs. That's a lot of money to send people up when they really don't have very much to do in space. If you look at it historically, the phenomenon is that the great promise that we all experienced in the 1960s that these brave astronauts were going to go up and pioneer a new frontier for us has been disappointing. In fact, we've learned that it costs more than we expected, it's more difficult, it's more dangerous, and the payoff from having people in space is far less than we'd anticipated. So I'm not sure it really is a very good bargain.
Former NASA historian Alex Rowland, thanks for being with us as we anticipate the launch of the Space Shuttle Discovery, a launch which he, among others, is harshly critical of. We are going to take a break with the countdown clock now still holding at T-minus 9 minutes. Should resume in just a couple of minutes. Stay with us for more continuing coverage of the return to space for John Glenn.
Have you done that rundown?
Freude, schöne Güte, Funken, Tochter aus Elysium. Wir betreten
The all-aluminum Audi A8. Developed with Alcoa, it's the first premium luxury sedan with a 10-star safety rating. No wonder everyone's singing its praise.
It's Thrifty Car Rental's 40th birthday, so let's get the show on the road. Call 1-800-4-CARS. There's something special going on at Thrifty Car Rental and Blockbuster Video. You rent a car from Thrifty, you get a free movie rental from Blockbuster Video. Just ask. When you rent a car at Thrifty, you'll drive home with a free movie rental from Blockbuster Video. Get the show on the road with Thrifty Car Rental and Blockbuster Video. Call 1-800-4-CARS.
Easy access and navigation. Fast trade execution. Very low margin interest rates. Direct real-time quotes. More independent research. Accounts protected up to $100 million. SureTrade. A comprehensive internet broker for independent investors. Because the market never sleeps.
For the 14 million women who worry about light to moderate bladder control, now there's new double protection Compose panty and pad system. The Compose panty and pad fit together for double protection. There's a super absorbent disposable pad, but the real difference is the separate washable panty. It gives you double protection with a quilted panel that won't let wetness through. So why worry? Get double protection with double protection Compose, protection that goes beyond the pad.
Looking at a live picture from the Kennedy Space Center, the Space Shuttle Discovery, and the first potential glitch of the day apparently has just occurred. NASA reporting some sort of master alarm situation, which may cause them to extend the built-in hold which they're in at this moment. Let's go to CNN's John Zarella with details. John?
That's right, Miles. NASA is saying they will extend the hold. They do not expect it to be a long hold, but it will be extended because of a master alarm that went off in the crew cabin, the vent system. This all is part of the procedure that we talked about why they stay in these holds, so they can run through their final last-minute checks. And during these last-minute checks, a master alarm went off, so now they're running through the system again. It's a cabin vent alarm. They do not believe it's serious. It may just be a sensor anomaly, but they're going to run through the system again, check it out before they pick up the countdown. That's where we stand right now. Miles?
All right. I'm listening a little bit to NASA TV right now as you speak, John Zarella. And, of course, this vent check is very, very critical as a spaceship ascends toward orbit. I had heard earlier, I thought, that everything checked out when they closed the hatch. What has changed since?
Well, apparently they had at least one alarm go off, and then there were some test conductors saying that perhaps a second alarm had gone off. They did not believe it was a serious situation, but they wanted to take the time now to go back and make sure to check it out, to make sure that this is not a serious problem so they can pick up the count. And again, they have emphasized they do believe that the hold will be extended, but only for a short period of time, indicating they think that it probably just a sensor and they can work through this. Miles?
John, just in your dealings with NASA, did you get a sense of the urgency of the problem? If you had to put it on a 1 to 10 scale, what would you give it right now?
It sounds at this point as if it's just one of those that's probably around a 3. They don't think it's anything very, very significant. Right. They'll get by. But they're always like that. You don't ever get the sense from NASA in all the years I've been covering it that you have a real serious problem until they get to the source of the problem, and then they find out exactly what they're dealing with. Right now, they don't think it is, Miles.
Thank you, John Zarella. Stand by. Please let us know if you have any more information. Dave Wolf is just been on the phone with the Launch Control Center. Dave, what do you hear?
Right, our integration and test team tells us that the master alarm went off at the time that the pressure check cap was pulled off. The set points are very close. It may have just tapped a set point. The exact data is being evaluated with Kurt Brown, the commander, right now. Likely this is just a close set point, not an indication of a problem. We'll know shortly.
All right, but help us understand this for the layperson. They're pulling a plug on the hatch, and there's a pressure drop when they do that. Is that correct?
Right. There's a momentary drop in pressure as the plug is pulled and the cap is replaced. The system is set to detect the pressure inside the cabin. When it dropped just slightly, it may have just bumped underneath that set point for the alarm system. This may be exactly what was supposed to happen in the situation, given that we had a slight dip in pressure as the cap was replaced.
It sounds like it would be an easy problem to troubleshoot. Is that correct?
It sounds that way at this point. We're going to have to let the launch control team do their thorough analysis. Hopefully it won't take long, though.
All right. Dave Wolf, Walter Cronkite, standing by here. We will keep you posted, of course, as this continues. Once again, John Zarellis giving it a 3 on the scale. Dave, would you agree with that?
Or less likely when we hear the real reason. Now, this may have been due to vent valves changing position in the cabin. They cycle vent valves at this point in time. We have to talk with Kurt Brown with exactly what was going on in the cockpit, compare it to the Launch Control Center data, and look at if this was an expected result or not.
All right. Once again, a reminder of how complex this spacecraft is. We're going to take a break. We'll be back with more continuing coverage of the launch of the Space Shuttle Discovery in just a moment.
Today on CNN, it's your chance to talk back to Miles O'Brien and Walter Cronkite moments after John Glenn's historic return to space. Today, 3 Eastern on CNN.
It's here, all new from the ground up for $19.99. This is the G20 of Infinities. Surround yourself in stylish yet timeless luxury at a price that will surprise you. The G20 is truly conceived in the tradition of other Infinities before it. You owe it to yourself to experience the amazing 1999 Infiniti G20 at Joe McPherson Infiniti in the Tustin Auto Center, where the dealer makes the difference.
Success has its rewards. Introducing Pelican Crest at Newport Coast, the ultimate reward for your success. Enjoy your accomplishments in a custom home in one of the world's most desirable locations. Breathtaking views, incredible amenities, and peace of mind. To find out more about building your dream home in Pelican Crest at Newport Coast, call or visit our Newport Coast exhibit in Fashion Island. Pelican Crest, the reward for your success.
Remember what used to be considered a fast internet access speed for your business? Then along came something a little bit faster, and then something a little faster. But just when you thought your business had seen the fastest internet access speed available, along comes Cox Business Services. 100 times faster than a 28-8 modem. Call today, 716-2020, the fastest internet access and telecommuting speed available. Cox Business Services. Everything else is just child's play.
Oh, we got trouble.
Shady insurance companies in California really hate to see me coming, because when they're ripping you off, it's my job to hold them accountable. We've forced insurance companies to refund nearly $1.1 billion to consumers and increased industry fines by 600%.
So I may not win any popularity contests with some in the insurance industry, but my job isn't to please them, it's to watch them.
Insurance Commissioner Chuck Quackenbush, getting the job done right.
Morning News, weekdays 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific on CNN.
Welcome back to the Kennedy Space Center. Live pictures. The hold continues. 9 minutes and holding as they work one problem, which we are told is a minor problem, with a detector which indicated some pressure gradient inside the space shuttle. That problem remains unresolved as best we know. They are now polling all of the people in the trenches at the Launch Control Center. Let's listen in as they do that.
Here we go. Cape weather.
Roger, sir. We have no constraints to launch. Over.
Ops manager.
MMT is go for launch.
See engineering one more time. Engineering Director 212. Go, no go.
We are still completing our pull.
Attention all stations, this NCD on 212. We will be resuming the count momentarily. Stand by.
We've remained in the built-in hold an additional 8.5 minutes so far.
So, I've completed my pull. We are go.
All right, thank you.
We'll wait for the Eagles call.
CDR launch director.
Go ahead, launch director.
Kurt, the launch team is go. Your vehicle's ready. The weather's beautiful out there. On behalf of the entire launch team, you and the crew at Discovery have a great mission.
Thank you very much, sir, and Discovery's crew is definitely ready to go, and we would like you to proceed.
NTD, pick up the count.
I copy that, launch director. And CISO, NTD? CISO? Up through recorder activation complete? Not yet. Okay, and the token train is picking up the hold at 9, is that correct?
Negative.
Copy that. And attention all stations, countdown clock will resume momentarily. CLS NCD, pick up the count on your mark.
CLS copies. Countdown clock will resume on my mark. 3, 2, 1, mark.
Now we are now at T-minus 9 minutes and counting. We heard NASA test director Doug Lyons conduct a poll of the launch team. Also Ralph Rowe, launch director, conducting a poll of his team. And Don McMonagle also giving the input from the mission management team. Also located here in the firing room. All systems are go
we've been listening
for
to
the
Lisa
launch
Malone,
of the shuttle
who is the
Discovery.
Voice of launch control here. Dave Wolf has been on the phone working on this apparent problem, apparently a minor problem. Dave, what have you heard about the, apparently it's been resolved. Tell us how it happened.
Yes, apparently it has been. It's the environmental control system person in the control center's final call. It's as we said, about an hour ago when the closeout crew took that pressurization check probe out to put the cap on, there was a slight dip in cabin pressure. The monitors that are supposed to detect that pressure and tell us if there's a leak got tripped. It's an expected situation. It sounds like at the current information we have, and since the count is going, I think this was the system working normally to tell us that we were losing a little pressure.
All right. Let's now that we've resolved the one glitch of the afternoon, let's give viewers an idea of what they're about to see. We had an opportunity a couple of weeks ago to sit down with Commander Kurt Brown. And I had him give us a sort of blow-by-blow account of what happens on the ride into orbit.
The way I describe that is it's you're sitting at the stoplight and somebody runs in the back of you and it gives you a big jolt and you're on your way. So that's pretty much liftoff.
A little whiplash.
Obviously, we're in the seats and we have all the headrests, but it's definitely a kick in the back when you lift off. The vehicle very quickly accelerates right up to 2 G's, 2+ G's, and we're on our way. We don't really feel the roll program. We see it more than feel it. We again just continue to accelerate. The vehicle has about 7 million pounds of thrust. It only weighs about 4 million pounds, so it's quickly accelerating. Approaching the 2 minute point, the boosters are separated about 2 minutes and 10 seconds. And approaching 2 minute point, the boosters start losing their propulsion. You know, we start slowing down. The acceleration bleeds off to about 1 G. Basically what we're seeing on the pad with, and then we have a big flash in the window and the boosters are gone, they're separated, and then we're basically just on the shuttle main engines feeding the fuel out of the big tank. And then we start a slow climb up the hill, we start accelerating again, the G level starts building up as we burn down fuel out of the big tank, and that happens up to about 7 minutes, a little over 7 minutes into a flight, the G continues to build. At that point, about 7:30 or so, we're up to 3 G's now. We've increased our acceleration up to 3 G's. The shuttle main engines start throttling back now to hold that 3G schedule because we don't want to go over 3 G's. And we hold that 3G profile all the way up to 8 minutes and 30 seconds into the flight, at which time the main engines are commanded to shut down. And we go from 3 G's, impressive 3 G's, because by that time you're really happy to get rid of that 3 G's. But it goes from 3 G's to 0 G in about a half a second. And it's quite impressive, quite an experience.
I find that hard to do.
Now we're back live now. We're back live, and that is the gantry, if you want to call it that, the white room that has been retracted from the Space Shuttle Discovery. We're now in the 5-minute range of the countdown. Difficult for me to see the clock where I am right now. The Space Shuttle Discovery, apparently everything all set and ready as far as we can hear. Let's listen into Mission Control, the voice of Lisa Malone and the communications between the commander and the controllers.
Correct. The countdown clock will hold at T-minus 5 minutes due to NTE hold request.
All right, you just...
There's a 10-minute hold coming up, didn't it? 9 minutes?
Well, we're past that now, but we're about to have a 5-minute hold, and we're going to try to figure out what that is all about. Apparently, we have a report of some aircraft in the area, and that obviously is an important
issue. T-minus 5 minutes and holding.
Let's listen to Lisa Malone.
Oh, with the countdown clock is holding at T-minus 5 minutes.
Again, the range safety officer monitoring the airspace within the Kennedy Space Center vicinity reported an aircraft in the area.
Well, the range.
Well, we've had aircraft in the area. We've had ships in the area. This isn't new.
Let's go to John Zarella, who has some more for us. John.
Miles, what they're saying is they have an aircraft in the area. They can't find it, so they are holding the count at T-minus 5 until they find out where that aircraft is or was, or if indeed it is in the airspace. That's where we stand. That's why they're holding. Range safety.
Well, I gotta ask a stupid question. If they can't find it, how do they know it's here?
Well, we're lucky it happened now.
Apparently, the flight path that it was on was taking it near here, and now it was supposed to have cleared the area in plenty of time, but it hasn't.
Launch team here will stand by.
Maybe the microphone picked up the buzzing in my ear.
Maybe so. How often does this happen? We're joined also, we should tell our viewers, by Bernard Harris, also a shuttle veteran, a man who's done spacewalks and who's now firmly grounded right beside us here. Bernard, how often do range safety considerations involve aircraft?
Well, most of the time it does, because you know they're scouring the skies above the whole area to keep people out. They're also doing the same thing on the surface of the water to keep ships out. And so it's the job of the range safety officer to make sure that nobody gets into that precious airspace that we're flying in.
They've got to worry about ships in the water, of course, out there, because they're going to dump those external tanks. Are going to come down when they come down pretty late. Not in this area, but the booster motors do. And they're going to be coming down with a parachuted down, but they come in pretty hard.
That's true. They have parachutes and land about 20 miles or so out, so we want to make sure we keep that cleared. It's kind of be startling to be in your boat and have this thing land on top of you.
Startling is a nice way of putting it. Dave Wolf, let me ask you this. Do you know what the sanitized no-fly zone is for shuttle launch?
Actually, I don't know the exact boundaries, but we had a range safety hold on my first flight. In fact, a cancellation due to a range safety issue.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, so this happens now and then.
Yeah. There's another consideration, too, and that's a return to Kennedy Space Center of abort. If they have to abort, they have to make a landing right back in here. They don't want a lot of aircraft in the area, or any aircraft in the area.
This is a vehicle which can't tolerate a holding pattern very well, can it? It's a dead stick landing with one try and one try alone, right, Bernard?
That's right. There's no holding at all, in fact. You have to come down and put it down the first time every time.
We're looking at pictures, I believe, of the offending aircraft up there. I think we saw it. Maybe not. We're not certain. It's an aircraft anyway. It could be the one. It may not be. Apparently NASA can't find it right now. We continue in our hold at 5 minutes. This is, let's see if we can listen in to NASA for a moment.
You know, any hold is a little worrisome because, as always it seems, you know, when things start going badly, they compound. And the hold, things happen. Things have gotten all keyed up to go, and then something breaks or something.
These folks have been on their backs now for 2.5 hours or so, and this is probably one of the more stressful, painful parts of the mission, is laying on your back with all this heavy gear. They'll be more comfortable as soon as the engine's cut off and they're in space. Their weight comes off and they're floating.
Yeah, they're not exactly Barco loungers, are they, Bernard?
No, not at all. I remember my first flight laying there for about two and a half hours, and you begin to wonder about those natural functions and that normally come into play here. And upon liftoff, though, that all goes away.
That's right. Of course, the first thing we activate is the WCS, Waste Collection System, when we get on orbit.
Well, comfortable not. I've heard that one of the serious problems out there is staying awake when you're lying there on your back that long.
Well, you know, I haven't told this publicly, but on my second flight, things were going so well and we were so comfortable in the hold that I actually dozed for a little bit until we came in the 9-minute hold and was shocked. We're going. And where I was.
As if to prove you have the right stuff. There's
you
Daniel
got
Goldin,
it.
The NASA Administrator, who is over near the Launch Control Center, or perhaps near the shuttle landing facility. It looks like she's on top of the LCC. Is that right, Dave?
Yeah, and that was Bob Cabana, commander of our first space station launch in 5 weeks.
Yes, and is he, his role in today is what?
I can't tell you exactly.
Okay. All right.
We got two-thirds or one-third of our astronaut office here supporting this mission.
Wow. Okay. All right. Well, Bernard Harris, we don't want you to fall asleep now. I'm curious, does the anxiety level go up on board the ship, or is this just like another sim?
Well, you know, we have we train many aspects of this, all phases. Nowhere can you get the entire training. So you do it in phases, and they have been through this. About 3 weeks ago, they came down here for dry count for those guys who are neophytes and new to the business. And that makes you feel very comfortable about the machine that you're about to fly in.
Did you feel comfortable, Dave?
Absolutely comfortable. The training and knowing the people, the talent here, felt good about it.
There are crowds all over the place waiting to see this particular launch. Hundreds of thousands expected along the Space Coast. There are some of them right there, training binoculars to the sky, wondering if they can see anything, perhaps listening on the radio, understanding the hold, perhaps not, wondering why it hasn't launched at this moment.
Miles, why don't we take those models and put them up here and show what's going to happen in the launch profile immediately after the engines start. If the countdown is picked up, we'll just drop this.
Sure, go right ahead, Walter.
We'll drop it because we don't want to break it. but it goes about like this. The at T minus 10 seconds, the command go for main engine start. And then T minus 6 seconds, these three main engines here at the base or the rear of the orbital spacecraft, they ignite. Now they've got to reach 90% of their thrust by T minus 2 or there's an automatic shutdown. At T0, that's the launch time, the solid rocket boosters here on the side, they ignite. That's when the whole thing looks like it's going up. Onboard computers command hold down bolts there to be blown, and that launches the thing into beginning its mission. And that's, at that point, there's no turning back.
140 million horsepower.
Yes.
It's hard to turn it around.
Yep. 7 million pounds of thrust. My God, that's a big firecracker. Now, as we see it goes up, we've seen these pictures many times. We're going to see it again today. That 7 seconds after launch, the shuttle will have cleared the tower out there, which we don't see here, which surrounds it now. It would clear the tower. The roll begins. The machine begins to roll over so that the spacecraft, the orbiter, is on the bottom and upside down. That's the roll and yaw. And that gives the crew a chance to see the horizon, to orient themselves in flight, which they couldn't do otherwise. Now, at that point, the control of the mission is lost from here and goes to Houston until the landing back here. Now, 30 seconds later, they've throttled back the engines. Up to then, they've gone up to practically full power. But the spacecraft is built to tolerate 3G, three times gravity, three times its weight. And with full power, at that point, still in the atmosphere, they'd be getting more G force than that and blow this thing apart. So they throttle back until they get through that atmosphere that is causing this buffeting at that point. And then they power up again and they're on the way to space. At T plus 60 seconds, 1 minute after they're up there, the shuttle's at around 33,000 feet, I think, right, Dave? More than 6 miles up anyway. And that's when the main engines are throttled up to 104% of their power. Two minutes, then another minute after that, the shuttle is 30 miles high, traveling at 2,890 miles per hour, it says here. I can't remember all these numbers.
That's right.
That's when the solid rocket boosters are jettisoned. So that's T plus 2 minutes. They're jettisoned. They parachute down after 17,000 feet, are recovered and rebuilt for future missions. At T30. 2.5 minutes up there, they go for transatlantic abort. That would mean that they no longer have to worry about their very difficult maneuver of turning around trying to get back to the Space Center here to land, but can land in Africa or in Spain.
If they lose an engine, they can still make it across
yep.
at that point, exactly.
Right. And that's about the story. Very shortly thereafter, the main engines are throttled down a little more. That's early on. What time do they go into orbit, actually? 17,500 miles an hour, 8 minutes plus, T plus eight, right?
Yeah, 8 minutes, 30 seconds.
I believe it's 8:30.
We have some news from John Zarella, who's down on the ground there. John, go ahead.
Miles, what we heard was that range safety reported that there were multiple contacts, that the radar was saturated within the box, which is a 10-mile by 30-mile wide box, and we seem to have seen actually what looked like skyriders in the distance. A couple of FAA aircraft have been sent up to chase them off, and I believe now they gave the clear, all clear, and in fact, the clock is ticking again. Miles?
Your timing's impeccable, John Zarella. As you stood there, the clock began ticking down once again. And gentlemen, we should not expect another pause at this point unless there is another problem, correct?
That's correct.
All right.
We should go all the way down.
This is what's going on right now, Dave?
It's time to start the auxiliary power units. This is what burns hydrazine. Three of them provides the hydraulic pressure for the aero surfaces, the ailerons, if you will, and to gimbal the engines. That's pointing the engines in the right direction, very critical. These engines will be gimbaled and tested over the next minutes.
They'll presumably advise us at T-minus 2 minutes that they have been able, they're able to scrub that 31-second hold that they built in there.
That's right. We'll expect an error to occur. There was a minor problem with the sensor determined weeks ago. It wasn't worth fixing, but it's going to cause a master alarm when the engines gimbal. And the data will be checked by the people in the launch control center, since the data has failed. They need to clear that failure flag, if you will, by 31 seconds in order to prevent the automatic launch sequencer from initiating automatically a hold at 31 seconds. So we should not see a hold if that error is cleared.
Bernard Harris, 31 seconds is a very important milestone in the countdown. What happens then?
It is. Well, let me back up and talk what the crew is feeling inside the time that Dave is talking about checking out the engines. This is the first time that as you're sitting there for the hour, 2 hours that you're in the vehicle, that the vehicle starts moving. You can actually feel the gimbling inside of this, and you know that you're about to go somewhere, and this is serious business. At 30 seconds, of course, you've got your visors down, of course, called at T-minus 2 minutes, and everybody is anxious and ready to get this show on the road.
And isn't it true at this point, too, the shuttle's computers sort of take over and then it becomes an opportunity, well, you're going to fly, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And that's another critical point, of course, because when you turn over the launch control computers to the onboard computers, then they all have to come up to speed and be able to take over launch.
Copy that, and work.
I have trouble reading the electric lights in that clock. What is that, 2 minus 30?
It's exactly 2:30.
38?
2:30.
I think we're all having trouble with that one. The way the sun is hitting the altar.
Please go for launch.
The computers are right now making thousands of checks per second of all the orbiter systems. If anything should come up, they will flag it.
What are we seeing here, Dave?
That's the retraction of the gaseous oxygen vent hood. That is a liquid oxygen tank filled with 500,000 gallons of liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen. That sucks the extra that's venting out of the top away. It's moving away from the orbiter.
So far, everything going according to the script, right?
Everything according to the script.
Yep.
Looks good.
Again, we're looking for the solid.
They're talking about the engine 2 pitch. I believe they're removing that hold. I believe that's what they just said. All right. The winds of discovery lift us onto the future.
Just
the visors have been closed and they've gone to oxygen, so they are ready to fly now.
Just an electric environment here today.
Okay, apparently there's another range safety issue to report. They're gonna hold at, I'm sorry. They just say the range was clear. They've removed the hold.
At 31 seconds, we go to a fully automatic computer-controlled launch sequence, checking just thousands of parameters per second. even checking the main engines after they're lit at 6 seconds, that they reach 90% thrust and everything's normal.
All right. All systems are go. That's the report we're getting from the Launch Control Center here at the Kennedy Space Center. That's the President and the First Lady getting up to see the launch. Let's just listen for the rest of the way.
T-minus 20 minutes, 20 seconds.
You're in mission control.
T-minus 15. T-minus 10, 9, 8. We have a go for engine start. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff of Discovery with a crew of 6 astronaut heroes and 1 American legend.
Houston Discovery, roll program.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
One minute and 50 seconds into the flight, Discovery now at an altitude of 25 miles, traveling at a speed of 2,900 miles an hour. The next event will be burnout and separation of Discovery's twin solid rocket boosters.
Discovery Houston, 2-engine Banjul.
Copy, 2-engine Banjul.
Capcom Susan Still informing the crew that in the event of a single engine failure.
Houston, performance nominal.
Copy, performance nominal.
Discovery could now reach the transatlantic abort site at Banjul, however, telemetry indicating all 3 engines continuing to perform well, and Discovery's performance to this point, 2.5 minutes into the flight, has been as expected. Discovery now traveling at a speed of 3,500 miles per hour at an altitude of 43 miles, downrange from the Kennedy Space Center, 70 miles. All systems are continuing to perform well.
That cloud's going to miss us, isn't it?
3 minutes into the flight, Discovery now traveling at a speed of 3,850 miles per hour, downrange from the Kennedy Space Center at a distance of 86 miles. Just about 5 minutes of powered flight remaining on board.
Three minutes or so into the launch of Space Shuttle Discovery. Everything is nominal, as NASA would put it. The President watching with binoculars, the First Lady beside him. The critical period of this flight everyone talks about is when the solid rocket boosters are attached to that orbiter. I think everybody breathes a sigh of relief who knows a little bit about the Space Shuttle when they separate, don't you?
That's true. It's a smoother ride afterwards. That's 5 million pounds of thrust that you've let go. You've used it all, and you're on the main engines. It's always critical, though. Let's keep an eye on all this.
What's going on right now, Bernard?
Well, what's happening right now is, as Dave said, we've got really solid rocket motors. Everybody inside is breathing a sigh of relief, and you can tell here at the Launch Site Control Center, people are also
And of course, the main reason that's the Challenger accident, and that's the most critical phase of the flight. So now the crew is sort of laying back and taking it all in, but physically, it's still a physical ride, very violent ride, very noisy on the inside. It's hard to talk to your fellow crew member, and right now the G load is beginning to build up, and we'll go just after the solid rocket motors are released down to 1.5 Gs and work our way up to about 3 Gs.
Right now, if we lose one engine, we can still make it across the Atlantic on 2 engines for an abort site.
And that would, in this case, be Banjul to Gambia. And at what point do we get to what is called the abort to orbit or abort once around mode?
At 4:12, we can make it to orbit without that engine. We'll press on up to orbit. We'd prefer that.
We have press to MECO right now, Dave, is what we just got the call.
We're apt to press to MECO at this point. Then we can get all the way to main engine cutoff, a nominal orbit, even if we lose an engine. So we've got redundancy in the main engines right now.
So this is the critical moment when we say you're headed to orbit, right?
That's right.
Unless we'd lose 2 engines. Then we can still do a transatlantic abort.
Now at a speed of 7,600 miles per hour.
Every inch of altitude you gain is in your favor.
That's right, and speed.
And speed.
Speed
is critical to get you safely in orbit. We have to reach what was termed in the old days escape velocity. That's around 17,000 miles per hour to work against the pull of gravity. So that's what we're working at right now.
Three main engines still up and running on board at Discovery. That call was that Discovery could make it to the transatlantic abort site at Banjul in the event that 2 engines should fail. But all 3 engines are continuing to perform as expected. Discovery now downrange from the Kennedy Space Center, 385 miles, traveling at a speed of 9,100 miles per hour at an altitude of just about 68 miles.
All right, what they just said is if they lost 2 engines, they could still do a transatlantic.
Still make it transatlantic, and momentarily we should be able to get to orbit even with the loss of one. Actually, we're past that point. Doing good. Looking very good.
We are going to take a replay of that launch because I got to tell you, that was a spectacular sight. And this picture that we saw today was extraordinary. Not a cloud in the sky here. Let's roll the tape back and take a look.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Booster ignition and liftoff of Discovery with a crew of 6 astronaut heroes. And 1 American legend.
Lisa Malone with her words.
Houston Discovery, roll program.
Roger, roll Discovery.
The words that have been so anticipated.
Right, you can really feel that roll.
Well, give me a sense of what the educated eye is looking for as you go up and as you watch a launch that you're not inside.
Well, we're looking for a very controlled roll that rolls directly to the azimuth that we desire and then stops and is stable.
That's really critical because that's going to head you in the right direction. Of course, when you lift off that much power, you want to make sure that you are going in the direction that is necessary for proper insertion. On my flight, we actually had probably the most roll trying to make it to the Mir station. And there were a lot of nervous people because we had to roll about 90 or so degrees and stop. Basically on a dime. And at that point, we did go past a little bit, but then corrected and headed off in the right direction.
Again, this is a laboratory going up to orbit. We only want to pull 3 Gs. We throttle the engines back in the last 2 minutes of the ascent to hold the Gs down to 3 because it has delicate instruments. This is also the 25th flight of this vehicle. And we can't do 7.5 Gs like John Glenn did on his first launch on a vehicle meant to go one time.
Good point. If you had to make all your experiments able to withstand 9 Gs, you'd have some serious problems. 3 Gs makes it a little more realistic. We're going to watch this to the solid rocket booster separation, which was really rather spectacular. You could see them sort of lazily tumbling through the air before the chutes would deploy and they would land off in the Atlantic and be recovered. Of course, to say they're recoverable is perhaps a euphemism. There's a lot of work that needs to be done on these boosters to make them flight ready again, right?
Really are. Once these come off, they are picked up out of the ocean and towed back. Sit in salt water for a long time, and they have to be refurbished.
Compared to the sophistication of this vehicle and its boosters, how primitive that flight 36 years ago. Do you know what John Glenn's assignment was at the time that his booster fell away and he was in the craft by himself. His one assignment was to keep his eye on the booster because they wanted to know how far a man could see in space.
It shows where we've come. At that time, we wondered if humans could even see. Their eyeballs might change shape. Could they digest food? Would their blood pressure be regulated? We had basic questions. We've gone so far beyond that in our research now.
All right. Well, in New Concord, Ohio, they have been watching this with probably as much anticipation as any place on the planet. Our Jeff Flock is there. Jeff, were there some cheers in that auditorium there?
Miles, what a thrill when this happened. I want to show you the scene, what happened inside this gymnasium. This is John Glenn's old college, Muskegon College, and let's just listen to it as it unfolded. Principal at John Glenn High. What was going through your mind at that moment?
Well, that was great. That was the excitement. That was just absolutely fantastic. I was here as a student in 62 when John Glenn went off, and I know the anticipation we all felt then, but it seemed like it was greater this time.
Were you scared at all?
Yes, I was scared. I mean, I just, having known him personally and still know him as a friend, I had a little bit of apprehension, but boy, was I relieved when I saw that thing go off.
Okay, a veteran and then someone new to it. Catherine Dobner's a student here at Muskingum. You really had a look on your face.
Well, it was, I mean, everyone was cheering, and the whole thing I kept thinking of is, he's not up there yet. You know, like, just anything could happen between now and then. And so it was like, until I couldn't see it, it was like, okay, I'm waiting. I couldn't cheer yet. The whole time, my heart, like, even my heart's still pounding from it, because it was just so amazing just to hear everyone scream and, like, the whole reaction.
Yeah, pins and needles here, obviously. Mr. Cronkite remembers all of the delays when John Glenn went up last time, and we thought we were going to have a repeat of that here for a moment, but folks that had been through that were kind of reminiscing about that, but everybody very happy here at his old college. Believe you, with that shot that we had out there that kind of gives you a perspective of where we are here in Ohio, in the middle of America. John Glenn on his way, and they're very happy here in New Concord.
Jeff Flock, thank you very much. A little slice of Ohio, the land of astronauts, apparently, for some odd reason. We haven't figured that out yet. Maybe we'll get an answer before the end of the day. We have one more replay to show everyone here. This one pointed in the opposite direction. Let's take a look as we look at... Go. 36 years ago, those were the words we all remember, Walter.
Yeah. I was almost speechless that day. Not quite as speechless as when man landed on the moon. I couldn't think of anything to say except gee whiz.
It's hard to come up with words to match the occasion.
Now,
Dave Wolf, you brought some old newspapers here, is that right?
That's right. I stumbled across a few things in the last few weeks. First of all, a copy of the Griffin, Georgia Daily News from February 20th, 1962.
All right.
We might remember this. Yeah. You could read that headline.
Is that where you were at the time?
That was the launch day. I was 5 years old. The average age of the crew right now was up, it's going in orbit, was 5 years old that day. You felt fine. Tremendous.
All right.
I think we all remember that. That
I wonder.
I was about 6 years old at the time. And, was inspired by what was going on in the space program to do what I'm doing today.
Walter, would you sign that copy for me?
Oh, I'd be honored to. I don't know why I'm entitled to do that, but I certainly shall.
All right.
Shall.
On that note, we will take a break. But before we do that, we're going to go to JSC first or after. All right, we're going to take a break. When we return, we'll check in with Houston. Tony Clark in Houston. Control of the shuttle has shifted there, and that's where we'll check in and see how things are going there.
John Glenn's Return to Space is brought to you by Lockheed Martin, the company that takes the most amazing ideas about the future and makes them fly, and by Norfolk Southern, the thoroughbred of transportation.
Lately, we at Lockheed Martin have been lucky enough to work on some very exciting projects. Like Project the most advanced automated fingerprint identification system in the world. Oh, and let's not forget the missions to Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn.
It's the transportation system of the next millennium. Moving the goods that move our economy. An advanced computer network will track every shipment. Experienced engineers will oversee each mission. But perhaps the most remarkable feature of this system of tomorrow is that it's here, today. Norfolk Southern, the future of transportation, is the thoroughbred of transportation.
Some 15 minutes, 7 seconds into John Glenn's second flight into orbit. Everything seems to be working perfectly well in the Space Shuttle Discovery. A fairly flawless picture here at the Kennedy Space Center. I don't know how you could make it look prettier than that.
That's just
can you come up with anything? I don't
flight.
Think so.
No. Wonderful flight.
All right.
Do it at night.
I get more nervous watching than being in it.
It is pretty.
Let's move it along to Houston, which is where NASA has moved things along, so to speak. Control of this mission, of course, taken care of all throughout its 9 days at the Johnson Space Center. CNN's Tony Clark is there. Tony?
Miles, you're looking at a shot of mission control in the center, and you can just barely see her. She's in a light-colored jacket. That is Linda Hamm. She is the flight director. She has the operational control of this flight. And to her right is, in the dark jacket, is Susan Still. She is an astronaut. She flew twice on missions last year. She is the voice of mission control, both to the shuttle and the voice of the shuttle to mission control. It was interesting watching as the launch was being on hold, all of the 35 or 40 or so people who were sitting at consoles patiently waiting. And then when the launch happened, it was interesting to note that there are about 7 or 8 TV monitors in here showing the liftoff itself, but no one was looking at those. All of the flight controllers were looking at their screens, data on their screens, monitoring how the liftoff was going of Discovery, because as you know, about 30 seconds into the launch, all of the control shifts from Florida to here, and it will remain here until the shuttle lands. Miles?
Tony, give us an idea of what's in store in the next day or so for this mission. It's a 9-day mission. There's a lot to talk about. What's on tap right away?
Well, you know, one of the things that gets deployed very early on is the communication satellite, a little military communication satellite. That will be interesting. A couple of days from now, the Spartan satellite will be deployed. That is going to look at the sun and the sun's corona, because the effects of eruptions on the sun have an effect on electrical grids, satellite communication here in the United States. And then there are a whole host of medical experiments that will be performed in the Space Hab laboratory that is inside the payload base. Just shortly after they get on orbit, they will open those payload bays, and that's when the experiments begin being exposed. They start turning on systems the rest of the day, getting everything activated. So it's still a lot to be done today.
And let's talk, you know, when they open those payload days for a very specific reason, Bernard Harris, that has a lot to do with the radiating heat in the space. Tell us about that.
Yeah, it sure does. And that was my job on the last mission, was to open up the payload bay doors and also to bring out the antenna for communications. The doors actually have the radiators in which to radiate heat. Many people think that it's cold in space, and that's true, and it's hot in space, but it's even hotter in the cabin because of all the electronics and avionics computers. They give heat. We pull that heat off and we run it through the radiators and radiate that into deep space, and that cools, keeps the spaceship cool.
You know, one of the things we hear sometimes about, but which astronauts sometimes are reluctant to talk about, is, well, the NASA euphemism is space adaptation sickness. And this is when that comes to bear, and this is the most critical time, isn't it, Bernard?
Well, you know, it actually starts on the pad. We have learned over the last 30 years, as you're sitting there for 3 hours or so in that recumbent position, you have this fluid shift from your legs down to your head, and that begins that process. And then you go in orbit under these G loads, and then 8.5 minutes later, you are exposed to zero gravity. And yes, this is where 60% of the crew members will experience the most
common space adaptation syndrome, that is space motion sickness. As the medical doctor on board our flight, it was my job to make sure that the crew was stable during that point because they have a lot of activities to do during that day.
Without naming names, was it a particularly rough ride for the crew, or is it typically okay?
It's typically okay. And when I say 60%, that varies. You know, some people just have a little sensation in their stomach. Others will outright have to use their bags on orbit. For the most part, you fly the second time and it's much better.
Would you concur on that one, Dave?
Yeah, I concur. This is an interesting time in orbit. It's very busy. They're converting this rocket ship into a science laboratory. Everybody is active. They're getting out of their spacesuit. There's a lot of movement. It becomes essentially a kelp bed of spacesuits floating around. And at the same time, they're adapting to space. Pedro Duque, for instance, is his first time in space. And he needs to get adjusted, but he still has a big job to do.
Absolutely, yeah. I would think, let's take a look at the president, by the way. He is at the Launch Control Center, taking a walk through. He was on the roof watching the launch from a little better perch than we have right now. Let's take a look at those pictures if we can. And he expressed some jitters before the actual, I guess he's in a car on his way there. Is that the... That appears to be a shot from the blimp. In any case, the space adaptation sickness, this is a recurring problem. I don't want to dwell on this because I know you guys don't like to talk about it too much, but the fact of the matter is, when you start looking at people, there's the president along with the First Lady, and in the foreground, Daniel Goldin, the NASA administrator. We can't hear what they're saying, but clearly offering some congratulations to the entire launch control team. Anyway, back to space sickness. It's been studied for many years now.
That shuttle, 7 to 9 times a year.
Let's listen to
Dan. They do it safe, and they do it on time, except when...